So good afternoon, everybody. Hello to everybody on Zoom and everybody in the room. Welcome to Physics Without Frontiers 10-year anniversary. Can I ask everyone on Zoom to please keep their videos off unless they are speaking and to keep themselves muted? When we have questions, you can use the reactions button to put your hand up and you'll be asked to put your question forward. And there is a chat which you can use throughout the meeting to put questions to each other or to the speakers as you wish. Okay, thank you so much for attending, and we will just start with our first talk by our kind director, Atish, who will give everybody a warm welcome to ICTP.
Okay, good afternoon here, and good morning and good evening to everybody who is joining in from all over the world. It's really a great pleasure for me to welcome you for the celebration of the 10th anniversary of the ICTP's Physics Without Frontiers program. I see that many people are connecting from Philippines, also colleagues from UNESCO, many of you know about ICTP. But some of you have heard about ICTP but have not been to ICTP. So I thought I will give a very quick brief introduction about what ICTP does. So as you know, ICTP was founded, we are in Trieste, by the Nobel laureate Abdus Salam. And we are governed by this tripartite agreement between the Italian government, UNESCO, and the International Atomic Energy Agency. And the idea was to really provide an international hub where scientists from all over the world can come together, and really as a way to use science as the common language to connect the world and to make scientific opportunities available to all the talented people around the world, overcoming the barriers of geography and gender or ethnicity or economics. And I think ICTP has been very immensely successful in supporting scientists from developing countries so that they don't have to face intellectual isolation. We have something like 60 conferences. I mean, apart from the very strong group that we have, various scientists who are permanent faculty here, we also organize 60 conferences each year. More than 5,000 scientists from 130 countries come here each year. And so this is really a way of promoting both excellence in science as well as inclusion in science. And some of you who are part of this Physics Without Frontiers program have seen ICTP also as a kind of a beacon or an inspiration where you might want to go. Here is, for example, our diploma program. This is a postgraduate program, and you can see really scientists, young scientists from all over the world here. Just to let you know, the deadline for application this year is 28th of February. And this is a pre-PhD program in the five streams that are available at ICTP, going from condensed matter physics, high energy physics, mathematics, earth system physics, quantitative life sciences, cosmology. So this is the kind of the step that comes often in the careers of many of you who go through the Physics Without Frontiers program, and some of them come to do a postgraduate program here. Some of them have stayed on to do PhD, and some of them have come here as postdoctoral fellows. So ICTP really has this lifelong engagement, and Physics Without Frontiers is really the beginning, starting with very young students in their masters, before their masters. And I have to thank both my colleagues here, Professor Bobby Acharya and Kate Shaw. They have been really the driving force behind this, and it's congratulations to them and for their dedicated work over the years that it has made this program a big success. You can see here Bobby, and Kate is not shown here somewhere, but she's sitting there. And we have 10,000 students have been be part of this program from 50 countries, so many different activities, 100 PhD students, postdocs, and professors have contributed to this volunteer network. So ICTP is really kind of pulls in all these international resources and makes it available to the world at large. And many of them, 300 of them, have gone on to do MSc, PhD, and postdoc. And so this program today is, I don't need to go through this program. I think we have a very nice, strong program. In fact, next week, in 2 weeks, we will be going to South Africa for the World Science Forum, and Kate will also be there, and there is a very interesting panel in which ICTP is invited, I mean, in particular the Physics Without Frontiers program, to showcase to the world this very important and major contribution of ICTP. So I just want to end with a very, what I find is a very inspiring story. Once I was visiting Hamburg to give a talk, and after my talk, a young woman scientist, she came to me, and she said that, okay, here I have a gift for you, and not for me. She said, this is a gift for Kate Shaw. Can you please take it to Kate Shaw? Because she said, I'm from Afghanistan. I'm the first woman doing a PhD in high energy physics in Hamburg. And this would not have been possible without the Physics Without Frontiers program of ICTP and without Kate Shaw. So thank you, Bobby and Kate, for this making this program a success. And thank you, all of you, all those who are participating. And I will now hand it over back to Kate, yeah.
Thank you so much, Atish, for that lovely warm introduction, and welcome to ICTP. So next on the agenda, we have Amal Kasri, who will be talking about the importance of basic science. Amal, are you online and able to share your screen and put your microphone on? Hello.
Hi, thank you very much, Kate. I will just give a speech, is not a presentation, because this is what I understood was needed. So I'm not gonna share my screen, I will just speak.
Perfect, thank you so much.
I hope this is okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Good morning, good afternoon, everyone. I'm really, really glad actually to be with you today. Dear Atish, my dear colleague, ICTP director, dear physicists, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, I'm extremely delighted to address you today at the 10th anniversary of the Physics Without Borders, Physics Without Frontiers, I'm sorry, excuse me. At the outset, I would like to thank the International Center for Theoretical Physics, ICTP, for this great initiative, being one of the 9 Category 1 institutes of UNESCO and the only Category 1 institute connected to the natural science sector. ICTP has an impeccable track record of accomplishments in pure science, international cooperation, science diplomacy, and capacity building. ICTP's Physics Without Frontiers strives to motivate and train physics and mathematics university students worldwide with a special focus on countries that are lagging in science and technology to help build the next generation of scientists. Over the last 10 years, we have seen the success of this initiative. Working with almost 50 countries and hundreds of volunteer physics and mathematics professors and PhD fellows, Physics Without Frontiers has trained more than 10,000 students worldwide and has hundreds of alumni who are now pursuing further studies, and some of whom have also become PWF volunteers. In this momentous journey, we cannot fail to attribute this success of Physics Without Frontiers to its founding and managing figures, physicists Bobby Acharya and Kate Shaw, who have enabled collaborations between UNESCO and CERN to further the objectives of ICTP. And I would like also to take this opportunity to thank CERN for its invaluable contribution to Physics Without Frontiers through the provision of its open data and tools to enable learners in countries with or without access to resources to pursue their passion in physics. Physics, which is encompassed within the science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, known as STEM, is also widely considered to be a critical building block for a range of STEM disciplines in terms of understanding physical phenomena. By and large, STEM is a key factor for innovation and a major driver for social, economic, human, and environmental development underpinning our knowledge, societies, and infrastructure. From civil engineers who design and build a country's infrastructure to medical scientists who develop treatments of diseases, every aspect of human life is controlled by the discoveries and the development of STEM professionals. However, the recent COVID-19 pandemic that disabled many economies and the anomalies in the natural world that affect daily lives globally stand the testimony to the unharmony between natural and the human world. The world is susceptible to more frequent, intense, and prolonged natural disasters and the new diseases and illnesses. Consequently, physics will continue to play a vital role in generating innovations, not only to develop new vaccines and treatments and the climate resilient mitigation measures, but also to minimize environmental destruction and increase resilience to achieve sustainable development. Physics will continue to play a vital role in meeting basic human needs, improving the quality of life, and creating opportunities for prosperity on a national, regional, and global level. A country's economic development and stability are dependent on its ability to develop and adopt new scientific research and technologies through experts with knowledge of up-to-date STEM research. Undoubtedly, STEM will play a vital role in underdeveloped and developing nations that seek to reduce levels of poverty, increase productivity, improve the standards of living, and experience sustaining economic, cultural, and societal growth. For those nations that are most vulnerable to the impacts of climate change, including developing countries and the small islands, STEM offers hope of greater resilience to destructive extreme natural events, droughts, storms, fires, and other calamities. For those nations with booming economies and who have aligned their national policies with the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, basic science and engineering offers great opportunities to achieve their national targets and the transition into green economies, as well as other countries on the same path. The inventions of today are altering people's lives faster than ever before. As indicated by UNESCO's science report published in 2021, it is indeed a race against time for smarter development. In terms of both informed decision making and its and also the digital economy. The transition to smarter development driven by digital technologies such as artificial intelligence and robotics, big data, the Internet of Things, and the blockchain technology defining the fourth industrial revolution is also heavily dependent on the advances in basic sciences. More and more young people are required to join the pool of STEM professionals as the needs of human to continue to grow. Therefore, physics education is vitally important in addressing the challenges of getting more young people, especially young women, into the fields of science and engineering. Despite the importance of basic science and engineering has been raised by decades, we observe low intakes of youth in STEM, and the trends haven't been changed much. Therefore, there is a need to reflect on how science is brought to the classroom and at the age at which youngsters are introduced to science. UNESCO's programs in capacity building in science and engineering provide new opportunities for the introduction of science at all ages. UNESCO's global microscience experiment, which I like to call a lab in a box, is an example of how UNESCO encourages student in schools lacking laboratory facilities to be exposed to the exciting world of science. Practical experiences are an essential part of learning science. However, in many countries, these experiments are not possible in schools, in the laboratories, due to the high cost, due to safety sometimes, waste disposal, and also capacities of teachers. This project that we aim through this project to provide hands-on science education to primary and secondary students through affordable and compact science toolkits to conduct practical work in biology, physics, and chemistry. We also target early career scientists and researchers via a series of hands-on training boot camps in novel basic science and engineering disciplines. As an example, we have started a series boot camp in nanotechnology starting next year, and we will continue with a minimum of two per year. We also have a new initiative to give remote access to scientists in Africa, and I will rely on ICTP to help us through these two initiatives. Ladies and gentlemen, the efforts of Physics Without Frontiers to motivate and enable youth to pursue careers in physics is the need of the time and deserve to be celebrated. Physics Without Frontiers is breaking down barriers to accessing physics and mathematics research and the training by connecting with the students and the scientists worldwide and with those from less represented groups. For example, from poorer economic background, women and girls, and ethnic minorities. I wish ICTP a great success, and once again, congratulations on 10 years of accomplishments through Physics Without Frontiers. Thank you very much, Kate, for the invitation. Thank you, Atish, for all the efforts. I wish you a very successful event. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Amal, for that kind talk. UNESCO is always a source of inspiration and access of knowledge for us at ICTP and UNESCO. So thank you so much for joining us today. So thank we'll you. Now move on to our next talk, which is by Professor Bobby Acharya, who will be talking about the 10 years of Physics Without Frontiers.
Let me begin by thanking Dr. Kazri for a very poignant presentation, and we look forward to working with you on and collaborating with you on your projects in the future. So welcome, everyone, I'll say again, from our Physics Without Frontiers team. Someone who hasn't been mentioned yet is Margarita, who is our administrator, who without whom not much could really be done. So, as has already been mentioned, so I won't spend too much time, you know, Physics Without Frontiers works to inspire, train, and motivate physics and mathematics university students all over the world, trying to focus on science lagging countries, to create the next pool of research scientists. So the aims, the major aims of the project are to sort of expose and introduce new ideas in physics to undergraduate and master's students, to give courses and training in key analysis skills, and as we'll see, other transferable skills. We really try to identify, since we get to interact with large numbers of young students, we have the opportunity to identify the brightest students, and we also have mentorship schemes and support for further study and to support the students in their future careers. networking is a huge part of the benefits of the program because students connect with lecturers, with active research scientists who can provide them with opportunities for positions or international collaboration, etc. And also, our programs bring awareness to the universities and institutions in developing countries that are hosting them. And we can emphasize the importance of physics there. Now, predominantly, Physics Without Frontiers wouldn't be able to function without a large network of volunteers. We rely on our network of volunteers to provide the activities. So if someone has an idea for a project in a particular region, they apply to us with the idea, then we help them to develop that idea into its final form. But as you can see here, we have most of the volunteers are actually young postdocs and PhD students from all over the world. What we actually do is a range of activities which have developed over the years, which can range from theoretical courses to kind of more practical training, for example, hands-on analysis training, like data analysis, even hardware and experimental training in some projects. We've done a lot of online courses and training. We sometimes deliver specialized schools in mathematics and physics, and also training in transferable skills like software and so on, programming. We're called Physics Without Frontiers not because we're talking about geographical frontiers necessarily. We're talking about many different types of frontiers. This could be social frontiers. For example, we have a bit of a focus on the gender gap in STEM. It could be geographical frontiers, of course. Socio-political frontiers, meaning we try to address underrepresented ethnicities and also have a focus on regions of conflict where it's very difficult to, where education and science systems may be rather poorly functioning, and also could be economic frontiers. So we focus on low income and science and technology lagging countries. And in the box there's a list of all of the countries that we've physically done projects in. And in many of those countries, we've done multiple projects and we have ongoing projects all the time. So I'm emphasizing here the gender gap in research. So this is the global percentage of research scientists, female research scientists. So the brighter colors, I don't know if you can see the key, but yellow is around 50%. And if you go down to sort of the pinkish color at the bottom is more like 25%. And this is to emphasize the problem. We, even though we have done projects specifically focused on women and girls in STEM, the way we address the problem more broadly is that we try to maintain gender balance in all of our projects, all of our activities. I wanted to emphasize briefly our focus on areas of conflict and insecurity. What happens when there's conflict in a region, it can completely destroy an entire generation of scientists. So, for example, if you look at what's happened, say, in Afghanistan, now there is essentially physics education is almost impossible in Afghanistan at this moment. So the problems are gross. And as already mentioned in the previous presentation, you know, there's a strong science sector is necessary to support growth. So, as this has also been mentioned, we're really happy that we've made it to our 10th anniversary. I want to thank all of our network of volunteers around the world, many of whom are connected today, so thank you very much. I want to thank especially Kate and Margarita for the tremendous amount of work that they put into the program, and also the other offices of the ICTP that we work with, like the director's office and public information office. I'll leave you with a reminder that the right to science is an actual is Article 27 of the United Nations Declaration of Human Rights.
Thank you, Bobby. Okay, so we will move on to one of our first talks from an alumni. This is Mr. Mohammed Al-Lissi, who will kindly share his screen and give us our talks. And after the talks going forward, there's a very short time for questions. So if you have questions in the room, you may raise your hand, or on Zoom, there is the reaction button where you can also raise your hand. Thank you. Please go ahead, Mohammed.
Hello, everyone. I hope you can hear me well. So my name is Mohammed. I am an example of a student who was supported by ICTP and Physics Without Frontier to continue his master's degree in Italy, and then make it easy for me to continue my PhD in Germany currently. So let me share my presentation. So I was born originally in Gaza Strip in Palestine, and I was too keen to study physics and science in general. I finished my undergraduate degree in 2013 from the Islamic University of Gaza. And after I finished my undergraduate, I was also eager to continue my higher education. So on the right, you can see a photo of part of Gaza City. And here below, you can see some buildings of my undergraduate university. Then after I finished my undergraduate degree, I started to prepare myself to have a scholarship. And I found that ICTP offered a program with the University of Trieste for international students to do a master's degree at the University of Trieste. So I got that scholarship in 2015. I was too happy. However, later I got sad a little bit, or maybe not a little bit too much, because I couldn't travel in 2015 from Gaza Strip to Italy. So then I contacted Dr. Keccio and other member of Physics Without Frontier and asked if there is an opportunity to have the scholarship or to postpone it later, because traveling from Gaza Strip to Italy is too difficult. As you know, in Palestine, there are no airports. So for my situation, I had to go to Cairo and travel from Cairo to Italy, but it was not easy to be done. It was not easy to travel in 2015. So Physics Without Frontier could convince ICTP to let me have the scholarship in 2016, especially to have an earlier visa. So usually at the University of Trieste, the master program start in October every year. So I could have the opportunity to come to STB in June of 2016 and have a kind of a small internship supervised by Dr. Ketcho in the summer of 2016. And in that period, I knew the system in Italy and at the University of Trieste. At ICTP, it was like a very helpful period for me to prepare for my master's studies at the University of Trieste. I would like to highlight that Physics Without Frontier, I knew about it by the workshops and lectures that they gave in Gaza Strip over the past 10 years. Like you can see on the right some photos, like for example, Dr. Ketcho, and she came and give some talks about Higgs boson when it was discovered. And also when I moved here to ICTP, like you can see in this photo, I hope the pointer is clear here. I had a meeting with my friend from ICTP, whose name was Rami. Also he was a diploma student, and we connected with people in Gaza Strip, with students who couldn't continue their education outside or who want to continue their education outside. Here, I would like to thank some people, Dr. Ketcho, Professor Joe Mella, and Professor Fernando Cuvedo, and Professor Sandro Scandolo, and Professor Poppy Acaria, because like these people helped me a lot in the beginning to postpone the scholarship and to come here to ICTP. And even though, like after I finished my master's degree at University of Trieste, I didn't want to go back home directly and look for PhD from Gaza Strip because it would be difficult again to travel. So I talked with ICTP and Physics Without Frontier people, and I asked them if I can do some workshop or some internship, some project to continue part of my master thesis after I finish it and after I graduated. And in that period, I could look for a PhD position in Europe or in US or somewhere else. But in that period also, I had a lot of communication with many groups here in Europe. And finally, I could found a PhD position at the University of Konstanz here in Germany. Well, now I'm talking from my office. And for people who don't know the city, like it is located in the southern part of Germany, close to Switzerland. This is a photo for it. And here you can see like my group colleagues and my professor Matthias Fox, who is expert in mode coupling theory of a glassy system. I would like also to highlight some workshops and activities that Physics Without Frontier did in Gaza Strip. You can see these photos were taken during these workshops and activities. And also Physics Without Frontier also could meet with some university professors here and in order to enhance, like to give us the students an overview about the current modern research in the scientific field across the world. So for me, like I found like Physics Without Frontier was too helpful for me, because I was supported by it in order to come to Italy, and I finished my master's degree in Italy, and I'm too happy I could obtain a PhD position here in Germany, and I plan to finish my PhD next year. And so for this reason, like I consider myself as a successful story that was supported by Physics Without Frontier. And for this reason, like I would like to say that Physics Without Frontiers should be expanded and supported, and it should be connected with some kind of network of members across the world, and where these members like can help each other, for example, like to give courses online or to travel to some places where there is no much access for physics or science in general. I guess this will promote science in the countries who are in need for science and research, or they don't have enough opportunities to travel, like students who are living there and they can't travel outside. And from my side, thanks to ICTP, thanks to Physics Without Frontiers people, and I hope we can see more and more in the next few years, as we could see in the next 10 years, over the past 10 years. And thank you for listening.
Thank you, Mohammed. So thank you for that inspirational story. And it's really big thanks to ICTP, who went beyond all expectations to help support Mohammed to come to ICTP early. And a big thanks to Joe Namella for sorting and working towards sorting that out. Does anyone have a short question for Namella in the room? Or on?
Thanks very much. Sorry.
Oh, please go ahead.
Thanks very much, Dr. Mohammed, for the valuable presentation.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Thank you. Okay.
This is Dr.
Thank you. Is that Asaman? Thank you very much for your comments. Okay, thank you, Mohammed. We will move on to our next talk with Christine Adele, who is going to be talking to us from the Philippines about the Physics Without Frontiers Physics Meetup. Please go ahead, Adele. Thank you.
Hi, Professor Atisha, Dr. Kate, Professor Bobby, and everyone there. Also Margarita, everyone there at ICTP and on Zoom. Can you see my screen?
Yes, thank you.
All right. So, hi everyone, I'm Adele, and it's an honor to present to you the impact that Physics Without Frontiers is making in the Philippines through the Physics Meetup. So PWF actually partners with Central Mindanao University, which is a public institution located in the rural province of Bukidnon in the southern part of the Philippines. And together with PWF, we create collaborative spaces for students in rural areas to meet and learn from prominent international scientists. So the PWF Philippines is actually a community of more than 50 volunteers with diverse backgrounds and from different regions in the Philippines. So we have volunteers who are students, teachers, and even a diplomat. So many of the volunteers are here on Zoom, and I just want to give them a special shout out for their hard work and dedication to promoting physics in the Philippines. And we also have 25 partner science organizations in schools, which really help us expand our reach to as many students as possible, especially in the rural areas. So our initiative actually started with a simple question for our students. So when we asked them who their favorite physicist or scientist is, many answered Albert Einstein, Isaac Newton, Galileo Galilei, and a few mentioned Marie Curie. But when we asked them if they know of any living scientist, they could hardly give any answer. So the same happened when we asked our physics alums who are now teaching in high school or college. So we thought that perhaps the limited knowledge of living physicists, the different career options, and the limited understanding of the impact that the current generation of scientists has in making our world a better place to live in, all contributed to making physics unappealing, especially for those in remote areas. So PWF Philippines actually provides exciting opportunities for those who have limited access to science to meet and interact directly with living physicists, thus exposing them to a diverse array of career options and exciting fields in physics. So while it is very difficult for us to invite international icons in physics to Bukidnon, an incredible resource came with the pandemic. So online platforms such as Zoom and Facebook bridge the existing physical and geographical barriers, which made us possible to invite scientists to our sessions conveniently from anywhere in the world. So from a small initiative in Bukidnon, PWF Philippines has grown to bring together physics students and teachers from all over the Philippines. So we have hosted 14 international physics science icons, such as Nobel laureate in physics Professor Donna Strickland, the NASA interdisciplinary scientist for the James Webb Space Telescope Professor Ruhir Windhorst, and the Breakthrough Prize for Fundamental Physics laureate Dame Jocelyn Bell Burnell, among many others. So in our 15 sessions, including a back-to-back session with physics teaching professor emeritus Roger Friedman of the University of Physics, we have accommodated more than 6,000 participants on Zoom, with more than 80% being students. And our live stream on Facebook has reached more than 87,000 people. So with most of the current opportunities to access science concentrated in the National Capital Region, where Manila is located, providing a platform for those outside the capital became our intention. So the increasing number of participants from the island of Mindanao, where 69% of the participants are from, including those from the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao, also from Dato Iguas Indigenous Peoples Integrated School, became more meaningful for us. So PWF has tremendously supported us in the Philippines, one of which is through a grant for mobile data assistance, benefiting 1,242 students at the moment from rural public schools. So through mobile phone data, these students could access the internet during our online sessions for free, so making the program more inclusive and empowering. So one student from Mindanao actually shared that the grant enabled him to get inspiration from the scientists and motivation to pursue a science degree and eventually a career in the future. Now, since most of the schools are now back to conducting face-to-face classes, our partner schools and organizations created ways for the students to access the sessions live and participate. So we have schools such as the Anaka National High School, Quezon National High School in Bukidnon, and also students at Central Mindanao University converted classrooms, covered courts, and audiovisual halls to streaming venues. So the Zoom meetings are actually converted or projected on TVs or screens, so everyone could watch together and learn from the experts and interact with them. So what PWF is doing in the Philippines has really created an impact that cuts across different physics learners. So with their consent, we are sharing some testimonials from our participants and volunteers. So we have an example, Mr. Hinayon. So Mr. Hinayon started volunteering during his physics undergrad. So the program motivated him to continue with his course, and now he is teaching physics to high school students. Ms. Punteras, on the other hand, is a physics teacher from Malitbog Agricultural High School. She shared that her experience whenever she joined Physics Meetup, she always looks forward to meeting international scientists that she is only familiar with from books or the papers that she reads, and she got to share her experiences with her students. We also have Julian Tamayo, who has been our volunteers since he was still with Bacolod City National High School. So after attending numerous sessions, not only did she get to listen to the lectures of iconic scientists, but she also got to interact with them and even asked for advice. So she is now pursuing an astrophysics degree for her undergrad at the University of California, San Diego in the US under a scholarship. So not only did PWF provided a platform to interact with icons in science to help students from rural areas in the Philippines to appreciate physics, but PWF also gave volunteers and participants the inspiration and motivation to continue and pursue physics as a degree and career. So our contribution to the accessibility of science not only did reach schools in rural areas, but we also made rounds through the regional and national news. So for example, our session with Nobel laureate Professor Donna Strickland informed the general public of her contributions to physics and the application of her work to, for example, medical eye laser surgery. So interestingly, in that news, a worker who underwent laser eye surgery was interviewed, and then the reporter segued it to introduce the concept of short pulse amplification. So this created an innovative way of telling the public that physics contributes to the development of humanity. So we still do wish to continue, and especially in making physics or science more accessible to students in rural areas of the Philippines. So we want to create posters, for example, about our guests, their field, their notable achievements in our own or vernacular language, and distribute them to rural schools for posting and for the students to see. We also hope to partner with more STEM public schools to encourage them to pursue physics degrees and careers. With the support of the Physics Without Frontiers and even our partners and volunteers and amazing guests, we are excited to make all these things happen, and all to create opportunities for Filipinos to have access to physics through encounters with international scientists and exposure to different physics career options. So on behalf of Central Mindanao University and the Physics Meetup team, and some of them are here on Zoom, I would like to congratulate PWF on your 10th anniversary, and we want to thank you from the bottom of our hearts for really having that passion to promoting physics to developing countries and including the Philippines. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Adele. Okay, do we have any question for Adele? Please.
Thank you. This was really a wonderful presentation and a great effort you're doing. I'm curious, seeing that you organize these online lectures for the whole Philippines, did you encounter difficulties with the background level in homogeneous? How did you deal with that for the same lecture of, let's say, a known physicist?
Yeah, thank you very much for that question. It's actually very valid. And yes, we encountered similar challenges, but we actually disclose it to our speaker that the audience are the general public. So we encourage them to level down their, you know, their presentation so that it would be understandable to the layman, because our intention really is for the public to help appreciate physics. And when they appreciate physics, especially those students, they will get to understand that, yes, they could be physicists in the future, or they could take careers also in physics. So yeah, that's one challenge. But we are grateful that our scientists really are doing their best, and, you know, they're experts, and they could also actually do a lot of things in making their talks more appealing also to the public and understandable to students, even though they are still high school students. So yeah, thank you for that question.
Thank you, Adele, and thank you so much for your and your team's inspirational work in the Philippines. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, we have our last talk of the session before the cake session with the coffee. And this will be by Mr. Pasu Sharma from the Royal University of Bhutan. Hello, Pasu.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. A very good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to all the speakers and attendees around the world. So with this, I would like to share my slide. So I hope my slide is visible.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. First of all, I would like to thank ICTP, PWF team for giving me an opportunity to speak on this very important day of PWF. This is indeed an excellent opportunity for me, and I'm incredibly grateful to be part of celebrating 10 years of Physics Without Frontiers. Congratulations for achieving 10 years of Physics Without Frontiers. So if I introduce myself, I'm Parshuram Sharma, an associate lecturer and program leader of physics at Sherabchi College, Royal University of Bhutan. I'm going to talk about the online training in high energy physics in Bhutan. That was a training on data analysis using particle physics data from ATLAS experiment at CERN in collaboration with Dr. Kate Shaw and her team from ICTP, PWF. So if I have to talk, if I talk about the brief history of Sherab Chikolis indeed was established in 1968 as a public school and in 1976 as a junior college under the University of Delhi, India. And in 2004, Royal University of Bhutan was established. Currently, there are 10 colleges under Royal University of Bhutan. So Sherabji College indeed is the only college in Bhutan which offers undergraduate physics program. BSc in physics generally, a 3 years program was started in 2017. Before that, it was a combined courses such as physics, chemistry, physics, mathematics, and physics, chemistry, physics. So here we mostly teach the fundamentals of physics and physics as a whole in Bhutan is viewed in theoretical approach. So what do the students do after graduation? So majority of our students try for the civil service exams. Some students join as higher secondary school teachers and some other try for a master's program in India and other parts of the world. So you can see some of the pictures out here. So I have inserted the Bhutan map here. This is the capital city, Thimphu. And you can see Tashigang here towards the east. So this is a place where our college is located. This is a top view of Sherabji College, a recent photo. And this is a front view of Sherabji College. High energy physics program in collaboration with ICTP, Physics Without Frontier. So getting connected to Dr. Kate Shaw was in fact a boon for the college. How did we get connected with the Dr. Kate Shaw? In fact, it was our Vice Chancellor Daso Ngidup Doji, who met with Dr. Kate Shaw in Thailand sometimes in 2018. So he introduced us to Dr. Kate Shaw. Likewise, we started our conversation with Dr. Kate in 2019, and in fact, in the conversation, we have discussed the status of physics program in Bhutan. Dr. Kate Shaw and her team from ICTP, PWF, had planned to visit Bhutan to render the support and training to the students and faculty members of Sherabji, but the sad part was COVID deteriorated our plan. The main objective of ICTP put the PWF was to motivate, educate and train university students studying physics or mathematics in the required field worldwide, particularly focusing on science and technology lagging country. Thus, Dr. Ketsha and her team initiated the online training. The project was actually intended to provide the hands-on training to BSc in physics students of Sherabji College, Royal University of Bhutan, on data analysis using data that are or were generated at CERN. Students of Sherabji College attended the program on collider physics using Atlas open data. So program was organized by Dr. Kate Shaw, scientist at ICTP, and I was the internal coordinator at Sherabji College. We had 16 students and all were from third year. From 16 students, 10 were boys and 6 were girls, who attended the 16 weeks online program. So what are the programs and activities as well as the objectives and challenges that our student faced in this training? So in this program, students were in fact trained in particle physics as well as in advanced data analysis using proton-proton collision data from the ATLAS experiment at CERN. The main objective was on data analysis training and to learn machine learning concept, and also to apply the curl-based analysis to search for the dark matter. For the first 3 sessions, students were introduced to the fundamentals of Python programming and also to the introduction of particle physics. There were in total 16 sessions in which 2 hours was allocated for each session. Students here learned to use the tools and perform their final projects to search for the dark matter using curl-based analysis and machine learning. The only challenges faced by the students was the use of machine learning too, because to be honest, most of our students lack the programming fundamentals, especially the Python programming and the machine learning. Maybe that was the only challenge. Maybe because of that, it was the only challenge faced by our students. Anyways, after successfully completing the 16 weeks program, the wonder thing was the final findings were presented in the form of poster. And we are really delighted to see the progress and achievement of our students. So you can see some of the photos out here. The first picture shown aside, that was the introduction part given by Dr. Kate Shaw. She was, in fact, introducing us, our students, about the fundamentals of particle physics as well as the machine learning. This was the same thing. And you can see the third picture out here, students doing some poster presentation. In this poster presentation, there were other faculties from other departments, especially life science, mathematics department, as well as the head of department of science was present during the poster presentation. So poster presentation, photo session, and the certificate awards. In this training, after completing the training, I have divided the 16 students into four groups, each group consisting of four students. And we have asked those four groups to come up with different posters on search for the dark matter using the concept of machine learning as well as the CERT-based analysis. And students wonderfully presented the poster. So I have displayed these four posters out here. The different posters, all the posters in fact talks about the search for the dark matter. So this was a photo session. After completing the session with Dr. Kate Shaw, and we have our head of science, Department of Science, and I was also present as well as other faculty members and the students of BSc Physics third year as well as other programs. Here you can see the students actively engaged in the poster presentation. They did a wonderful poster presentation. And after completing all this thing, we had a final photo session with the students out here after awarding them the certificates. So this program was really wonderful. Students were overwhelmed attending the program as they got to learn some basic concepts or a course of particle physics such as basic concepts, structure of matter, and fundamental interactions. The use of machine learning tool and the CERT-based analysis was although challenging for some of the students, but I can say it was very useful should they plan for the further studies in particle physics related field. One of our students also expressed that physics is not only the things we learn in the class, it is something more that we can see and apply in the real world. Head of Department of Science, who attended the poster presentation, also said that such program is of very first kind in Bhutan, particularly in physics, and thank the coordinator for the same, expecting a very similar high-level programs in the near future. So what were the impacts, in fact, for both the students as well as the students? I can say the impact after attending the program was very huge, and this was a very first kind of program we have ever conducted at Sherabji College, Bhutan. So out of 16 students who attended the program, four are planning for their master's program in particle related fields. Two are doing intern in the Tech Park Bhutan in the programming field, advancing in Python programming and machine learning. Honestly speaking, after attending the program, some of the students are really interested in this programming field. They really wanted to learn programming up to the high level, especially the Python as well as the machine learning. Likewise, two are working in the automatic street light controller circuit using relays and LDR at Sherabji College. And this is a great success, I have to say, because students applied the concept of the programming and they are working on it. And there is a successful story as well. Some are planning to go for the medical physics related fields and others are preparing for the civil service exam of Bhutan. Now to, as a university as a whole, the impact to understand and determine the most fundamental building blocks of matter and their interactions for the university like ours, shared up to college is extremely important. Why? Because students will learn to solve challenging problems in a very competitive environment. Finally, we still have some further plans with ICTP. The program that we conducted earlier was the first phase, and the second phase of the project will be dedicated towards faculties of physics program, Sherabji College, and will be provided capacity building training on curriculum development, development of laboratory and research infrastructure facilities for both undergraduate as well as master's level, because we also have a plan to start master's very soon in the future. The faculty members will also be introduced to some of the proper mechanisms for building bilateral cooperation, as well as the collaboration with other international and academic institutes and industries around the world. Thank you, and tashidile.
Thank you. Okay, do we have a question for Pasu? Thank you, Pasu, for that wonderful talk. It's so nice to hear the students enjoyed, because this was all done remotely in 2021, so we never met the students. So it was all done over Zoom. Do we have any questions from Zoom or in the room? Maybe I've got a question for you, Pasu. So do you think you're going to go forward with the curriculum of including more aspects of particle physics, or indeed more data science, such as the programming in Python or machine learning that we did during our course?
Right now we have a 3 years program here, BS in physics program. We have a plan to start the 4 years BS in physics program. And we are planning to include the high level of particle physics as well as the Python programming in our program structure. Because I can see the interest shown by the students as well as the faculty members out here. And they are indeed, they were really happy to be the part of, to see such programs conducted by the ICTP team.
And you mentioned the master's program. Do you know when that will be up and running for students to enroll?
We have a plan to start the master program in 2025.
Perfect.
So we'll be starting the master program in 2025.
Wonderful, Pasu. Well, thank you so much for your work and all your work you're doing to promote physics in Bhutan. Let's thank Pasu and all our speakers again.
Thank you so much.
Okay, we will take a short break. So everybody on Zoom, you may go and have a cup of tea, maybe a slice of cake if you have one in the fridge. Here at ICTP, we have some birthday cake to celebrate with you all. So we will start back sharp at 2:30 Italian time. Thank you. Everybody, I hope you've had a nice break. Nice cup of tea. We're lucky enough to have some birthday cake here at ICTP. We'll try to post some cake out to you all after the session. Okay, so let's kick off with our next session. We're going to be hearing from Dr. Mohammed Al-Roub about particle physics in Palestine. Hi, Mohammed.
Hello.
Hello, go ahead, Mohammed.
Okay. Thanks a lot, Kate. And I will speak about physics without a frontier in Palestine, difficulties and reach. So first of all, I would like to thank the organizers, Kate, Sho, and Bobby Acharya, for inviting me to talk about, again, the physics without a frontier in Palestine. So my name is Mohammed Al-Haroub, and I am a postdoctoral fellow at the University of Oklahoma in the US, and I am based at CERN. Okay, so let's start. So it was an idea in summer 2011 by Dr. Kate Cho, and she suggested to do some particle physics activities inspired by the international master class. And she to me and she suggested that project, and honestly, I was very suspicious or unsure whether it came or not. Anyway, she insisted and we went forward, and it was not straightforward to organize such a project. It took us 6 months to organize it. We needed funding. We needed volunteers to travel to Palestine. We contacted universities, and actually it was very hard to convince the universities to participate in such a project. For example, Bir Zeit University accepted immediately the proposal, but other universities took so much time, and finally three universities agreed: Al-Quds University in Al-Quds, Bir Zeit in Ramallah, and Al-Najah University in Nablus. In addition, we contacted a high school university in Ramallah. It's Ramallah High School for Girls, and accepted to let us talk to the girls for 1 hour or to speak about, let's say, particle physics in general. Okay, so we went to Palestine, three universities, one full day session at each university, four lectures in particle physics, atlas and particle detection, accelerator physics, and opportunities in physics abroad. We had hands-on session using Atlas Open Data. And finally, at the end of the day, we had a virtual tour to Atlas control room where the host was Steve Goldfarb. And at the end of the day, final ceremony, and we distributed certificates. Four volunteers participated in the section. They showed the organizer, me, Ahmed Basalat, and Sharif Ghithan. I highlight Sharif because he volunteered by himself, and also he managed the funding to travel. Okay, so it was a very successful session, despite the difficulties. And I have an iconic photo taken at Al-Quds University. And the three of the students participated in that session. Currently, these days, they are postdoctoral doctors in Germany. One of them, Ma'zouz Aghnimat, who came to CERN in 2012 as summer student, then went to the ICTP as diploma student. Then she got her PhD in particle physics at Bonn University, and now she's in Ziegen. Asma and Sabrine, they did their master's degree at Al-Quds University, and they finished their PhD in nanotechnology, and they are at Jülich Research Center in Germany. Okay, in 2013, we made a small session because we were experimenting. So one session was at Bir Zeit University and a virtual tour. But that year, Kate Shaw and with the organizers from Bir Zeit, Dr. Wafa Khadr, talked about a particle physics course, online course. So they started that course. The lecturer was Professor Bobby Aksharia, and the tutor was Bill that Bir Zeit, but of course, Ketchu was traveled for 6 months. And I show a photo, three of the students participated in that course currently in Europe. So actually one of them in America, Ahmad Panina, he finished his PhD in nuclear physics and currently in US, Mohammed Faraj. Now he's a postdoctoral at the ICTP. Tasneem, she's a postdoctor doing detector development in Paris. And one of the girls called Suhad, she managed or finished her master's degree in physics at Bir Zeit University. She was a summer student, but of course, she didn't pursue her graduate studies. Of course, the particle physics course was repeated in 2014, 15, 16, and so on. So in 2013, as I said, Bobby Aksharia and Kate Shaw, 2014, Kate Shaw and David Marsh. 16, it was taught by Viraf and other tutors like Lucas and Eric. And in 2021, Marwan Najjar, who was a former student at Bir Zeit University. And currently, they have another course called General Relativity by George Obeid. So one of the activities organized during the particle physics course, or as a part of the particle physics course, is a trip to Sesame project in Jordan. It was organized in 2015 by Kate Shaw, and you see the students in front of the main building there. Expanding the program, the physics without a frontier, I mean, for guys in 2014, 15, 16, 17, and during COVID we couldn't travel, and many universities participated. So we started by Al-Najah, Bir Zeta, and we have the American Arab University. Many students, many people volunteered, like, for example, Mahmoud Esteti, Marwan Al-Najjar, some of the students or volunteers or who moderated, organized the Particle Physics Without a Frontier were former students who joined in 2012 and 13. So let me speak about the impacts. Many universities, as I said, participated in the program regularly. Particle physics course also taught regularly every year. Students become aware of high energy physics activities and opportunities. And of course, it's like a snowball. One or two students inspired to pursue their graduated studies at the ICTP or come to CERN as summer students or travel abroad. And of course, they encourage their colleagues, and more colleagues encourage more colleagues. So it's like a snowball effect. And rough estimate, there are 30 Palestinian students doing PhD, master degree, or postdoctors abroad. And I'm sure if I check my Google Drive, or if Kate or Bobby check their Google Drives, we will find a comprehensive list with all names and their achievements. So here I have a collection of photos with the students like Ma'zouza, who was a former student, or Tasneem, or a photo from Arab American universities and or different volunteers. We have many, many photos with volunteers, with the students excited and happy to participate, or volunteers even to talk to students and inspire them. That's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mohammed. Thank you. Do we have any questions for Mohammed? On Zoom, you can raise your hand with the reaction button. Okay, I think we have a question from Ahmed, who has also been working with Physics Without Frontiers for many years at Al-Najjar. Ahmed, please go ahead.
Yes, hello, good evening. From Nablus, from Palestine. So thank you very much, Mohammed and Kate and Bobby, for this this very nice initiative and project. So in this slide, I'm staying with Kate and Hadil and Arwa in 2014, where I participated with this activity as a volunteer. And actually then, I would like to share with you that this initiative has a good impact in Palestine. So it has good reputation on many aspects. I backed to Nablus in 2016, and we initiated also a winter school in such domain, and the physics and the high energy physics activities become more aware in Palestine. And that's really a milestone that we can count on, and we can even develop it more. So thank you all for this kind effort, Bobby and Kate and Mohammed, and we'll appreciate it from our side in Palestine. So hopefully we can go on even with other projects.
Thank you, Ahmed. So for people that don't know, Ahmed's in the bottom right there. He came on several of the trips to train students across Palestine. Thank you, Ahmed. Any other comments or questions for Mohammed? So Mohammed, just to say, how many students do you think are now on to further study from for Palestine?
Yeah, I mean, I have to estimate 30, perhaps more.
Thank you. And I see Hadil, who is another of the people in the photos who worked, I think it was in 2016 with Physics Without Frontiers. Go ahead, Hadil.
Hello, good afternoon. So My name is Hadil Abiyarub. I'm the head of the physics department at the Najah University in Nablus. So you see me here in the photo on the top right. At the physics department at the Najah University, actually, we are always open for collaboration and further collaboration. We have very strong relations with CERN and other international institutions. So thank you for your initiative at the ICTP. We are always here, open, motivated for future collaboration.
Thank you, Hadil. Yes, we're looking forward to visiting again soon.
You are more than welcome.
Thank you. Anybody else that has got a hand raised? Okay, thank you so much, Mohammed, and to everybody for your comments talking about physics in Palestine. We will move on to our next talk by Dr. Reina Camacho, who's going to be telling us about high energy physics across Latin America. Please go ahead, Reina.
Hi, can you hear me? Can you hear me well?
Yes, thank you, Reina.
Okay, perfect. Okay, just let me enter full screen. So thanks a lot for the invitation. We are really happy to be here celebrating with you this 10 years anniversary. And I'm giving this talk actually on behalf of many people who plan and run and supported the activities that we have been running in Latin America since 2016. And this is a story about creating networks. This is a story about collaboration, in particular virtual research and learning networks in order to support the accessibility to resources, the modernization, and also the internationalization of the different institutions in Latin America, and a story about how the Physics Without Frontier program has supported our efforts, in particular with two main programs, the road shows in Latin America wide. This will be the first program that we will discuss and that we will be presenting that took place mostly between 2016 and 2020. And also a second one, that is the advanced lectures on theoretical physics that started this year and will be running in 2023 and 2024 as well. So maybe before going to details about this project and about these programs, let's put a little bit of context about the situation in Latin America. So it's, Latin America is big. So we have 20 million square kilometers. We have 33 countries, more than 650 million people, and around 0.001% of them are researchers. Globally, let's say in average, we have less than 0.7% of the GDP that is spent in science in these countries. And there is a very solid physics schools in the different, in most of the universities that were created in the 40s and in the 50s. But it's a very, being that big is a very heterogeneous development and situation in the different countries. And even not only at the country, between different countries, but also at the country itself, there are big differences between the big cities and the universities that you can find, for example, outside the main cities. So one of the things that is important to point out is that, in particular, the field of high energy physics, high energy cosmology, and astroparticle physics communities has been growing a lot in Latin America in the last decades. And this is thanks to different programs and to different experiments, like, for example, the fact that the observatory Pierre Auger is in Latin America in the south has contributed a lot to this development. We also had a couple of exchange programs between Europe and Latin America supported by the European Commission, like HELEN, the High Energy Physics Latin American European Network, and ePlanet, the European Particle Physics Latin American Network, that help a lot with mobility for Latin American researchers, and this really give a boost to the HECAP community in the region. So much that right now we have more than 1,000 researchers in this field, and we are starting to organize ourselves. And recently, a couple of years ago, we had the first strategy forum for research infrastructure for HECAP in Latin America. So this is a very important step for the community in the region. However, the development is heterogeneous, varies country by country, but it has a lot of potential in the sense that there is a critical mass of teachers and researchers in several universities that are interested in continue pushing and strengthening the field in the region. There is a diversity of interest and skill that has been developed in the last few years because many in many universities and in many countries, we are participating in big collaboration, in big experiments at LHC and the Observatory Pierre Auger, et cetera. There is a young generation with potential and especially with a lot of eagerness, a lot of interest to learn, to participate in this research field. And the most important thing is there is the eagerness to collaborate, and collaboration makes us stronger. So one thing that started on one program that we started in 2014 was the Virtual Center of HEP Studies, or CEVALE 2VE. So this actually was something that started by a group colleague of students that of postdocs, let's say, just finishing the PhD, group of Venezuelans doing postdoctoral studies. Many of them actually were part of these programs that I mentioned before, Helen and ePlanet. And we wanted to bring particle physics to Venezuela. So we created CEVALE 2VE to promote the scientific dissemination, education, and research of higher energy physics. The important thing is that this community grew and it was extended to institutions beyond Venezuela, institutions in Colombia and in Peru. In addition, researchers from other countries also joined the community, researchers from Colombia, from Ecuador, Mexico joined us as part of the community. And this extension was part of Physics Without Frontiers. Actually, the fact that we got to create this community within CEVALE. So what CEVALE did was four editions of a postgraduate 60-hour course, Introduction to Particle Physics, that has open material online courses, and we had more than 120 students. But the activities were online, right? So we were given the courses, etc., and we were missing the possibility to meet the students, to meet the people in Colombia, in Venezuela, in Peru, in Mexico that were following the courses. And Physics Without Frontiers actually gave us the possibility, this possibility that we were missing, thanks to the role chose. And then since 2016 until 2019, we were running annual visits to several countries. Like for example, the first year we were visiting Venezuela, Colombia, and Ecuador. In 2016, we also visit Peru. In 2018, Argentina and Uruguay became part of the roadshow, and then in 2019, we also included Mexico, for example. So this was a great opportunity to continue strengthening and growing this network that we were created. The roadshows include a lot of activities, seminars, conferences, hands-on sessions where the students analyze LHC, the Large Hadron Collider Open Data, also career and opportunity session in higher energy physics, and even master thesis collaboration projects were an output, a result of these connections that the roadshows allow us to do. So increasing and strengthening the network and reaching more students and teachers in the region. I cannot say enough how much grateful we are for the program, but also for all the people and the local researchers in the different countries that we visited that made this possible and help us organizing all the different visits. So here you have some pictures about some pictures from the different visits that that these roadshows or the different activities within these roadshows. For example, you have a visit that we did in Lima in 2017, Lima, Peru, in Bogota, Colombia in 2019, Caracas, Venezuela in 2016. What you want is to mention one of the quoting one of the students that participated very actively in the courses of Cevale and also in the roadshow, Manuel Morgado, who mentioned that the experience taught us the importance of working in collaboration with other researchers in the country as well around the world to efficiently perform this task. At the University Simón Bolívar, the students are looking forward to repeating this fascinating experience. This was in 2016, and this actually motivated us a lot to continue this roadshow through the years. In particular, I think this is the opinion of Manuel is very nice, because Manuel is now in conjunction with other of the students that participated in these roadshows and in the courses of Cevale. They have a group that are now running activities actually with the ICTP as well. So it's a network that grows and brings more activities, which is great to see. Some other pictures from these visits. And here I wanted to quote one of the professors, actually, that helped us in the organization from Bucaramanga, Colombia. He mentions that at the Universidad Industrial de Santander in Bucaramanga, Colombia, we have benefited a lot from the effort of Cevale 2, with a student from our emerging astroparticle group participating in the two editions of their particle and detector physics course, as well as the Physics Without Frontiers program. From the lectures, the projects, and the interaction with the instructor, we have profited from their first-hand experience in detector physics and data analysis. We immediately apply these skills to several local projects, in particular our muon telescope to study volcanic inner structures in Colombia. Thanks to this group of enthusiastic and dedicated young researchers, our group has become a very active in astroparticle fields. So this is just one example of the importance of the work that Physics Without Frontiers has been doing. And thanks to this network that we have been created right now, we have now we are now in a second phase, let's say, of the community. We managed to get some funding from the European Commission, in particular a program that is called Erasmus Plus. And we created a program that is called Latin American Alliance for Capacity Building in Advanced Physics, or for short, LACONGA Physics, that has as objective to modernize education system in four countries in Latin America. So we have participating in institutions in Colombia, in Ecuador, Peru, and Venezuela. We have a virtual learning platform, remote teaching laboratories, scientific and technical internships are also part of the program. And as a proof of concept, we have created a 1 year of common and interinstitutional master degree in the universities that are participating in Latin America. So we went from one course of 60 hours to a full year master program. And all this network strengthening and creation was thanks to the support of the program. Actually, ICTP is one actually of the partners of the LACONGA Physics project that has an initial stage and funding from 2020 to 2024. So, let's move to the second project that is part of the activities in Latin America, which is the Advanced Lectures on Theoretical Physics. It's a project led by Daniel Galvis from the Tsinghua University. He's in Bonn right now. And together with ICTP, Physics Without Frontiers, and Universidad de los Andes in Venezuela, and a huge and great set of teachers and special lecturers, they put together a series of lectures on theoretical physics for Latin American students. They also provide mentorship for students and sessions of career opportunities. So here you can see some pictures of the first courses on QFT that took place in 2022. Here you have some of the students that were participating in the quantum field theory course, so it's really a great list of lectures and special guest lecturers as well. So if you want to check the backup material of the slides, you will find more information about them. The courses has a final exam and homework, so therefore they can they can validate and they can get credit in the universities for their courses. So here you can see the different courses that they have planned in the next few months. So they will be running from this year until 2024. So mark your calendar because, I mean, they have put a lot of efforts and it's really a great agenda that they have for these courses. And if you're interested, the application for the quantum gravity and the geometry and topology in physics courses are open right now. So thanks a lot. This brings me to the end. And instead of summary of a summary, I just wanted to say, we just wanted to say thank you. And cheers to many more years motivating and training physics and mathematics students worldwide. And cheers to more networks, collaboration, and interest in science. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Reina. Thank you, Reina, for covering that incredible tour around all the fantastic work you and others are doing around Latin America over these last few years, and all that incredible impact and the new initiatives you've been working on. And thanks for also sharing some of the other work from other Physics Without Frontiers volunteers. Okay, do we have any questions? I see on Zoom we have a hand up from Alvaro. Hi, Alvaro.
Hi, Kate. How are you? Hi, Reina. That looks excellent. I just wanted to ask you a small question. When are you visiting Guatemala? We would be very happy to arrange for that.
And we will be very happy to visit.
I think we can organize a roadshow. I'm very happy to put you in touch with the right people. And it's amazing what you guys are doing. It's really impressive.
So. Perfect. Let's discuss offline about that. We are very interested also. Right now, we are thinking about the new activities and the La Conga physics 2.0. So we're thinking about what to do, and we will be very interested. We have been in contact with some people in Central America. We will be very interested in actually expanding and bringing some of the institutions to work with us. So, yeah.
Congrats.
Bobby.
Of course, if we can support the project in some way, please let us know, of course, Reina and Alvaro.
Thanks, Bobby.
Excellent. Thanks a lot, Bobby.
Yeah, I was going to ask Reina if you have more plans in collaboration with Central American institutes and students.
So again, we have been in discussion with some colleagues in Honduras about bringing some institutions into La Conga. We had a couple of students from Honduras joining La Conga, just listening to the course and participating to the course. So we are thinking in that direction actually. Central America has been also very active in the last free effort, which is the forum for the strategy in Latin America for large infrastructure. So we are going in that direction.
And I think Arturo had some connection or some workshops in Honduras maybe a few years ago. Was it 2 years ago now? Anyway, we'll hear more about more from him later.
Yes. I saw him connected earlier.
Yeah, I think he is. Okay, thank you so much, Reina. You really did cover a huge amount of material there. And thank you to you, as I say, and your team. You've just done an amazing amount of work across the continent. And the new initiatives and funding you've found has been really impressive and inspirational, I think, to everyone. So thank you.
Thanks, Celia.
Okay, so we will now move, staying actually in Latin America, up to Guatemala. So Dr. Alvaro Veliz will be talking about programming, machine learning, and quantum computing in Guatemala.
Very good, very good. Let me see if you can see my screen. I think you can see my screen, right?
Perfect, thank you.
All right, so just give me a second. Okay, so first of all, it's an absolute pleasure to be here with you and to see the ICTP. It used to be like a second home for me when I was a younger man. It's a fantastic place, and I think that Physics Without Frontiers is perhaps one of the most exciting vehicles to bring that spirit of ICTP to the world. And I have to congratulate you for all the things you've done. I'm just going to tell you a little bit about what we've been doing with the team in Guatemala. We go back to 2018. I met Bobby and Kate kind of by chance in the, you know, in the Adriatico residence, I think, and we started discussing about the possibility of doing something in Guatemala. And basically, what we did in Guatemala maybe has a slightly different angle from what has been done in other places, and this is quite deliberate. What we wanted to do was to create schools that were very hands-on, very self-contained, and that could serve a broad range of students going from the second, third year of undergrad, and not only physicists. So we wanted to have physicists, chemists, mathematicians, computer scientists, and basically what we wanted to do was to give them tools that were both valuable as researchers and also if they wanted to move into industry. And this is something that is very close to my heart because now I'm not working in academia. I still engage in these kind of events, but I'm running a startup incubator and a venture fund. So basically what we do is that we work with a lot of physicists. Most of the people we work are physicists, mathematicians that want to start companies in different spaces. And basically what we wanted to do with these courses was to give the tools to students of physics to also go beyond the academic realm. So far we've organized three events, three short courses. The first one was in 2018 already. Well, and it was a very nice course on practical programming, really getting your Python straight, getting things to do right, knowing how to write good code, how to document it, how to use GitHub. And this was supported by both Kate and the great Kurt Rinnert, that it's a hero for us in Guatemala. He was there with us in two schools. This first school, we had, I think, around 40 students, and many of them went on to do a lot of interesting things. Some of them are doing their PhDs, their masters abroad, and some of them are working in startups in Guatemala. I'll probably go a bit more into this, the kind of support that we had also from the private sector in this one. Then we decided to do a follow-on on that course in 2019. In 2019, again, we had Kurt with us, which was amazing. And this time we involved a startup incubator in Guatemala. And this time we focused on machine learning. And what Kurt did was also, again, an amazing course where we started with very, very basic ideas of machine learning, statistical learning, making sure that people really learn the basics, that we can transform all this knowledge from statistical mechanics, from calculus, and transform it into something that could be used both for work in particle detectors. That's actually how we ended this course. In particle detectors and also for work in industry. And in fact, we had a competition, and in this competition, the winners, I don't remember exactly how it was the setup, but some of the winners went for an internship in a machine learning startup that just started in Guatemala. And this was an excellent experience. Then we had a hiatus in 2020 because of COVID and a series of things. It was a bit of a complicated year. But then we came back on 2021 with a vengeance, and we organized a very, I think this one was a fantastic school in quantum machine learning. And this school was actually here, in this time we tried something slightly different. And I think we're gonna stick to this type of schools, that we had a very, very detailed propedeutical course that was taught by local professors, so that they would be really, really well prepared for the course. And this was taught by, I'll give him a shout out later, by Giovanni Ramirez and two excellent teaching assistants. And the course was a course on basically the state of the art quantum machine learning. And it was given by Marco Cerezo, that it's a researcher at Los Alamos National Lab. He's been doing amazing contributions to the field lately. And this time we accompanied the course with, so this course was again very hands-on, and we accompanied the course with short plenary style talks by people, a combination of people from industry and academia. And this is where we use our connections with the quantum computing startups and also large players. So we had Amir Abbas from IBM. We had Juan Miguel Arrazola, that is he's the guy that is running the algorithmic part at a startup called, well, not anymore a startup. they just raised a lot of money. So a scale up in Canada that was doing photonic quantum computing. We had Loic Henry that works with me on the private sector, and he's the chief technology officer of Pascal, that it's a startup in Paris that uses neutral atoms for quantum computing. And we have Balin Koshor from the University of Oxford, and Vincent Elfming that was teaching us how to solve differential equations using quantum computers. It was a very nice course. And we're planning already next year, what we're gonna do next year, we're probably gonna go into the lower level of implementation in quantum computing, quantum control, both for quantum processors and also for experimental quantum physics. Like if you want to run an experiment, sometimes you want to really find the optimal parameters. And we're talking to, again, in this spirit of both industry and university, we're talking to someone in a university and to someone in a startup that to give the course together. So in this course has a very nice highlight for us. We had Marco is a Guatemalan student, not a student anymore, and it was very nice to get our own people kind of to get back and tell us a bit about the amazing things they're doing. So our philosophy has been, again, there are a lot of transferable skills that are very important, and we are not learning it in a systematic way in Guatemala. People kind of catch haphazard some idea from here, some idea from there. And what we're trying to do is to do it as systematic as possible, learn how to do things in a very clear way, learn, make sure you master the basics and that you know which things can be used outside. So that way we want to make sure that students don't think that they have only one path for their careers. Another thing that we have really emphasized a lot is to learn by doing. So most of the courses we've organized are brutal tutorials. They're really long tutorials where people have fun, where they try to solve problems. They're really, really, it's really, really important for us. And also we have competitions. We try to end each of the courses with a competition where students are assembled into different teams and they try to solve an interesting problem. And generally there is some nice reward upon winning this competition. Here we have a picture from our first Physics Without Frontiers course. This is my alma mater, La Universidad del Valle de Guatemala. And so as I was telling you, another nice thing that came out of this is that we have a very detailed, if you want also to have access, we have very detailed GitHub repositories, where we have the lecture notes, we have the notebooks, exercises, and if someone wants to grab them, of course, you can let us know, and you can go through almost the entirety of the course and learn all the things that we did. And even we have access to the data set, so you can try to reproduce some of the calculations that were taught by, especially by Curtis. Okay, so another thing that has been very important for us is to bring a lot of stakeholders together. Not just the traditional academic stakeholders. Of course, we worked with three of the main universities in Guatemala. We had the support of the School of Physics of the National University, Universidad de San Carlos. We worked with the Universidad del Valle de Guatemala. They actually were the hosts of our first school. And we're also working with the Universidad Rafael Landívar, that it's a university that is more focused on the humanities, but we also wanted to bring science closer to people working in the humanities, and we don't want to go beyond just the academic environment. And for example, here we organized a nice event with Kurt and with Kate. This was in Guatemala. It was in a cool bohemian place, basically people having drinks. These conversatoria are about art or about history or things like that. We decided to bring the people from Physics Without Frontiers both to tell a little bit about this amazing enterprise of bringing physics to the world, and also to talk a little bit about how particle detectors are built. And because we believe that one of the crucial things in our countries is that there is no scientific literacy beyond we have a group of physicists, they're a bunch of really smart kids, and they have big dreams, but also we need all the other people to know what's going on, policymakers, entrepreneurs, investors, etc., etc. And this is highlighted by some of the partners we had. So this is some of our private sector partners from the that have been helping us organize the schools and have given a lot of visibility to the talent pool that it's in, that is latent there in the physics and mathematics departments. We have the tech, that it's the first technology incubator in Guatemala. We have Fundación Crecer, that it's a foundation that is basically focused on the development of knowledge neighborhoods in Guatemala City. We have Kingo Energy, that it's, I mean, not any longer a startup, but it's an energy startup from Guatemala. They have some interesting business model to bring electricity to remote communities. They were involved in supporting these courses, and they employed one of our people now. I think he just moved, but he was the chief data scientist of the startup, was one of the students from this course. And then we have two startups from Europe that are actually my clients. They work for my firm. I mean, my firm kind of was working with them. We advised them in their fundraising strategy, but we became very good friends with the chief technology officers, and they decided to give us their time to participate as lecturers in our courses. Now, the most important thing for me, and I'm just going to give a shout out to four of the people that have been the most involved here. First of all, I have to say Juan Diego Chan. I mean, Juan Diego is the real hero. The thing is that he's very busy, so today I had to take the presentation. But Juan Diego is the person with the boots on the ground. He's been making sure that these schools work, that everything goes according to plan. He's a brilliant physicist. We have also Giovanni Ramirez. He is, I think he's an alumni of ICTP, if I'm not wrong, or his wife. He might be an ICTP alumni. He's an excellent quantum information physicist and he's starting a little research group that is doing super amazing things in Guatemala. And then we have our latest TAs, that are Subadra Echeverria and Felipe Coroy, that these are the people that organize the tutorials so that all the students are ready for facing these very challenging schools. Now, I just wanted to wrap up. I wanted to keep it brief so we can talk. And I just want to say many congratulations. Happy birthday, and keep up this mission that you have. I'm a huge fan of what you guys are doing. And whenever you need my help in any way, I'm always available for you.
Thank you, Alvaro. Thank you. That's a fantastic talk. Your team and yourself have done an incredible job over the years, and the way that you really focus on technology and knowledge transfer, transferable skills, and how you made this connection with local industries. It's really interesting, and I think many other programs would love to learn from you and to see how they can mimic some of these wonderful tools that you use. Okay, do we have any questions for Alvaro? I see we have a hand up from Desmond. Desmond, please go ahead.
Thank you very much, Alvarez. I'm very happy for the presentation. Please, I just wish to find out, I have been very interested in machine learning, and you just said if we want to get more information concerning that, we could get to you. How can we get that information, please?
Sure, so I'll give you my email. I'll put it here in the chat. I'll put it in the chat. I cannot see the chat now, but I promise I'll put it as soon as I stop sharing. Write to me, and I'm happy to share with you information both on the GitHubs that we have for the basic introduction, and also advice that we've given to students that want to continue learning a little bit more about machine learning and really get up to speed to what is going on now. It's like crack pop.
Thank you very much.
I'll put it in the chat.
Thank you. Yeah, and we should mention that all the materials made by Physics Without Frontiers are actually all available to be shared around. So if there's any projects that you're interested in and you'd like to ask for their materials, we're very happy to share between all the projects so that you can, you know, use each other's materials and resources. Thanks. So Alvaro, I was going to ask you, so you've done, practical scientific computing, You've done introduction to machine learning and now quantum computing. I'm very interested to hear where the program will be going next.
Yeah, so our plan is to, I'm guiding it a lot for the startups I'm supporting on my kind of day job, where I help them fundraise. And there is a startup that is based in Finland. And what these guys are doing is that they have some very cool Bayesian methods to control quantum hardware. But the thing is that the Bayesian tools are amazing for a bunch of other things. So I think we're going to organize a course on Bayesian-based, very hard to pronounce, quite a mouthful, control. And we'll probably have two angles, one on methods for experimental physics and one on hardware design. So this is, I think, the next thing we're going to do.
That sounds amazing. Bobby's giving the thumbs up in particular. Okay, any last comments, questions? If not, thank you so much, Alvaro, for giving up your time and talking to us today. And thank you. So we will be moving on to the next speaker today, which will be Professor Sahal Yacoub. So he's from the University of Cape Town, and he will be talking to us about promoting women in physics in South Africa. Hi, Sahal, can you hear us?
Hi, yeah, I can hear you. I'm just working through the details of sharing my screen. I think it's best if I do it this way. Ooh, there we go. Okay, can you see my screen?
Lovely, yes we can, thanks.
Perfect. Sorry about the delay, and thank you for the invitation. It's really nice to be here to help you celebrate the great work you've been doing. I just need to put on a disclaimer. I'm currently on call, so if something drastically goes wrong with the piece of the detector that I'm in charge of, I will have to just pause or stop. So hopefully that won't happen. So I'm based at the University of Cape Town, and that's based in South Africa, which I hope everyone here is familiar with, but I stole in these slides from when I first presented this work to a different audience. So of course, South Africa is at the southern part of Africa. Our demographics are, we're up to about 61 million people, 51% female, 36.2% age between 15 and 34. Most households have access to water and access to electricity, but access to water in this case might mean a communal tap in the middle of the village. For some of you who might not know, we had our first democratic election in 1984. Prior to that, we were a society segregated by race. We are 8.1% white, which is the official classification used in South Africa. And it just means a previously from Europe. About 20% of the population cannot afford food, and that's 20% of all households. We have about 35% unemployment, and about 55% of the country is below the poverty line. So the poverty line is considered $58 per month. And a case of beer, for example, is $12 approximately. And one last thing that's not on the slide is that 60 to 65% of the wealth of the population is held within 10% of that population. So that's South Africa. And we're still a predominantly patriarchal society. Preference is generally given to males to the extent that while Kate and I were doing this project, we heard stories about the women that were part of this project that helped us having to give things to their brother and being worried about not being able to study because their brother wanted to study, or there was one bicycle in the household and it was obviously for the boy. We have official policies in place to encourage previously disadvantaged groups, and that is spread along all lines. So it's racial and gender-based and sexual orientation-based. We have a very progressive constitution, but these official policies make a small difference in a big problem. As of 2011, 17% of university leadership were women. All these numbers are in science, engineering, and technology. 21% of full professors were women, and almost half of natural and agricultural science doctoral graduates were female, and 15 to 17% if you expand that to engineering, science, materials, and technologies doctoral degrees. So there is maybe some hope there that we have a young up and coming generation that will fix a lot of the imbalances that I've been speaking about. Sorry, we have frozen. There we go. In my anecdotal experience in physics, I've been employed at two universities in South Africa. And just to keep them somewhat anonymous, although I guess you can look me up, Institutes A and B. One had a complement of 10 physics academics. The other was 15. And at one of them, there were no women on permanent members of staff. At the other, there was one. And then if we count non-white South Africans at one of them had changed from 2 to 1, and on the other one from 2 to 0. So not really moving in the right direction. So with that in mind, Kate and I worked together on a project. It focused on women in physics because we got our funding from the South African Institute of Physics. We have a subgroup that support women in physics, and they wanted to encourage increasing diversity and addressing gender balance. And we started with the idea of how does one picture a physicist? And I guess you all kind of know that this is the answer. This is the popular view of a physicist is the quintessential Einstein. And this is not something that students in South Africa can identify with. This is a very foreign image. It's somebody who's older. It's somebody who's not come through what they've been through. And we wanted to see, could we change that idea and what effect would that have? This is a more recent picture. This is the South African Institute of Physics annual general meeting banquet dinner. And so you can see from this picture that physicists in South Africa are already much more diverse than one would expect. And our idea was to go through current physicists in South Africa, women who have physics degrees, and make posters about them and their journeys, and then send these posters to schools where they could be displayed and hopefully encourage people to pursue physics, to let them know that people like you, people who faced your struggles, have done physics, have graduated, can do this. If you see your favorite sci-fi show, you too can do that. So after a selection process, we ended up with 7 candidates, reasonably diverse from South Africa. These are samples of the pictures that we took with them. With each of these candidates, Kate and I met for a few hours. I think sometimes the most was up to, with Tana, the woman in the middle at the bottom, we had to drive out to the site of the SKA, so we spent a weekend with her, so that was the most. And with some of them, it was maybe just half a day, where Kate, amongst her many skills, showed her talents as a photographer and took a series of pictures. This is one of our subjects and just surrounded by some of the quotes that we had from them. We recorded our interviews with them. We had ideas to expand this into a bigger project with links to the interviews and try to get it published, but none of that eventually came to fruition. So just from these women, traditionally a woman's role is to stay home and take care of the house and kids. So you want to go to university and do what with that degree? It's the type of thing they would hear. I think they're intimidated by women. They cannot accept a woman doing better than them. When my mother wanted to go to school, her dad said no. A woman who goes to school becomes undesirable. So women don't go to school. They must listen to their husbands. So that's how village people are raised. If we have a boy and a girl and we have a bicycle, then you'll find the boy always will have the first go until he has had enough. Then it's the girl's turn. A girl can't be better than you. You know, it starts with the small things. Back to the situation in South Africa, even though we are no longer segregated by law, this is a picture of St. John's College, a well-resourced school in Johannesburg. At the same time, in the last few years, we've had an epidemic of children being injured and passing away in pit latrines in schools in South Africa. A pit latrine is sometimes called a long drop. It's just a hole in the ground that's used as the toilet. So we're still very diverse, unfortunately not in good ways. And we made these posters and went out and saw some of the schools that these candidates came from. They were not all from the St. John's College level. Unfortunately, we haven't been able to assess the impact of these posters. They've been used often online. ICTP, I think, has used them. The South African Institute of Physics, the University of Cape Town has used them. They've been shared a lot, particularly on days in support of women and diversity in STEM. There was a plan to assess the impact at schools with questionnaires and sampling across the various different socioeconomic levels and geographies within South Africa. Unfortunately, that was just too hard to do with gaining consent appropriately from minors. We would just depend too much on the people at the school, and they weren't really that interested unless we combined the study to the more well-resourced schools. And even then it was going to be a problem. So we have 50 hard-printed sets of the posters that are being displayed in schools in the Gauteng province, but we haven't been able to assess the impact. And the posters have been taken off the SAIP website. I hope we'll be able to get them put up somewhere in future so that somebody can use them if there's value. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sahal. Brilliant. Thank you so much. And it's really nice to see a project completely devoted to promoting women. I think, yeah, these posters are all very pretty. There's some printed versions outside if you want to have a look later. Okay, do we have any questions for Sahal about promoting women in physics and this specific project in South Africa? So I wanted to ask, just while we're waiting to see if there's hands up, Sahal, I wanted to ask about the situation socially in South Africa. Do you think things have changed a little bit from the times when those interviews were taken, in the way that women in general are seen in society? And do you see the path towards more equity in physics being dependent on that? Or do you think that we can make progress in science with equity and reducing the gender gap going forward?
Kate, sorry, I wasn't expecting quite a composite question. So I think, let me see if I can remember the various pieces. I don't know enough about the broader South African society, but the physics community is trying, and the scientific community at the university level is trying particularly hard at the universities I work with and I've been involved with. We've employed more women across the faculty. Unfortunately, that hasn't translated in the physics department, but across the science faculty, it has happened, and I consider that part of the win. And I think we're seeing more students coming through as well. So I think in our sphere of influence, we're seeing some change, and maybe that echoes what's happening further down. But I really don't know what's happening in the poorer villages, right? I hope there's some change, but I think the change happens generationally. I don't think it's a 10-year timescale even is enough that something would have changed too much. I don't remember the rest of your question.
Yeah, no, that's absolutely right. It's always a difficult topic, isn't it? How to increase underrepresented groups in a field, and then also to how to measure how successful different attempts and projects are. But this is really nice. Do you have any plans for the future to work more in gender or any other underrepresented groups?
No, I don't have any concrete plans. It's something that I would always do given the opportunity. Mm-hmm. But I've changed my life a little bit in the last year, so I'm now in operations in Atlas at least for the next year,
yeah.
Which is a kind of full-time job.
Yeah, based at CERN at the moment. Yes, of course.
Time to do this.
Well, good luck with run three. I hope the detector doesn't break too badly in the next few weeks while you're on call. Thanks so much, Sahal.
Thank you, Kate.
So we'll move on to our last talk of the session today. This is by Dr. Makhamiza Senekane, and this is going to be about quantum physics in Lesotho. Hi, Makhamiza, can you hear us?
Hello, Katie. Yes, I can hear you.
Fantastic.
May I please share the slides?
Thank you.
Just please give me a moment or so.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Unfortunately, my laptop, I cannot share from my laptop, so I'll present from the mobile. I hope that would be okay with you.
That should be fine. We might be able to share it from this side. Although we can see your screen quite well, it's a little bit smaller.
No.
They're on the Indico.
They're on the Indico page.
Oh.
Perhaps I can share from my side. Yeah, so I can share from my connection here. Oops. And okay, Makhamiza, if you stop sharing, I can actually see if I can share my screen. And you'll have to tell me when to change. Okay.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. Good, I think in my case it's good evening. Good evening, everybody. And I'd like to take this opportunity to congratulate the Physics Without Frontiers for the 10th year anniversary. So my name is Makhamiza Senekane. Even though the slide is supposed to be presented by my colleague, Dr. Nalil Machulo, I will be the one presenting. I don't see my slide. Sorry, Kate.
One moment. It's it wasn't sharing completely properly. Full screen. that's better. Sorry, Makamisa, do go ahead.
Thank you very much. May I please go to the next slide? Thank you. So our presentation with my colleague, Dr. Naledi Machilo, who could not be able to attend this event, it's about the quantum computing project that we are having in Lesotho, where we are trying to introduce quantum computing to undergraduate students in Lesotho. It's a project that is supported by both the Physics Without Frontiers and the National University of Lesotho. So like I said, my name is Makamisa Senekani. I'm from Lesotho, which is in Southern Africa. Fortunately for me, Professor Yakubu has just provided a brief overview of Southern Africa. And Lesotho happens to be landlocked within South Africa. So having provided that background about South Africa, they also covered Lesotho. So for those who might not know where it is, it's landlocked within South Africa. So back to this project, the idea of the project was to devise the outreach program that focuses on introducing and the hands-on training on quantum computing to undergraduate students in Lesotho. So Lesotho, unfortunately, Lesotho, most of the programs are undergrad programs. We don't have many postgraduate programs. So that's why we targeted specifically undergraduate students with background in mathematics, physics, and or computer science. So like I said earlier, the project was organized jointly with the National University of Lesotho, and the picture on the right is just one of the buildings of the National University of Lesotho. And the organizers of this quantum computing school in Lesotho are Dr. Kate Shaw, myself, Makamisa Senekani, and Dr. Naledi Machilo, who is currently still based at the National University of Lesotho, while I have moved on. I'm now in South Africa at the University of Johannesburg. So far, we have run two successful programs on quantum computing school. The first project was in 2020. November 2020, and then we ran the second one last year in 2021. Hopefully, you will have more programs to run. I'll cover a bit the challenges that we are facing so that we could see why maybe this year we haven't had any quantum computing school yet. Oh, please go to the next slide. Thank you. So the goals of this program are twofold. The first goal is to introduce quantum computing to the undergraduate students in Lesotho. This is because quantum computing does not form curriculum of programs within our universities in Lesotho. So the only way to give students exposure is to organize that quantum computing school so that you could have an idea of what the field is about and maybe participate later. The second goal is actually to encourage the students to further their studies in quantum computing so that we could build the critical mass of quantum computing within Lesotho. Next slide, please. So in the first program of 2020, we hosted the event at the National University of Lesotho because they are providing all logistical support and any support that they could offer to us. So the school was attended by 34 undergraduate students who, like I said earlier, who have background in mathematics, computer science, or physics, and or physics. So from that event, only two of the three universities in Lesotho participated, with the dominant participants coming from the National University of Lesotho, which is the hosting institution. So of the 34 students who attended, 8.8% or three of them came from that university, Budinich University, while the remainder, 31 or so, came from the National of Lesotho. In terms of gender representation, unfortunately, the event was dominated by males. There were like 30 males to only 4 women. It's one of the challenges I'll discuss later, that we still have the problem of women enrollment in STEM programs, even in Lesotho. I think it's a global problem. Thank you very much. Next slide. So in 2020, we had a pleasure of actually encouraging ministrants, and we carried out a lot of tutorials and hands-on exercises where they were requested to bring their own laptops so that they could run all the codes in the program. We were using the notebooks also. So these are some of the pictures that we took during the event. On the top left corner, we have the demonstration where we were in class and they were trying to do the exercises during that break of exercises during the lectures. So the next two pictures are actually group photos that we took after the completion of the course, which this program ran for 2 days. It was a 2-day program. So we can see, even from the pictures, like visually, it's mainly dominated by males instead of women. Next slide, please. So after successfully conducting the program, like hosting the program in 2020, November 2020, we had a follow-up quantum computing school in 2021, which has still hosted by the National University of Lesotho. However, relatively, in terms of attendance, it was relatively poorly attended as opposed to the 2020 event. So one of the key challenges was that currently, for the last year and this year, Lesotho is still having a problem with institutions of higher learning because students are protesting a lot about funding from the government. So the attendance wasn't that good because of the protests that were ongoing at the time. And it's also one of the reasons that we couldn't host one quantum computing school this year because of the continuous strikes that were ongoing in Lesotho. So for this event, only National University of Lesotho participated. Other universities didn't show up because it wasn't logistically possible for them to travel to the National University of Lesotho. Next slide, please. So in this case, we tried to see the impact or the effect that the quantum school had, especially the first cohort of students. From the first cohort of students, we were able to have at least one student showing interest and eventually enrolling for the postgraduate studies with the ICTP. East African Institute for Fundamental Research. I think it's in Rwanda. Yes, it's in Rwanda. So it's one of the impacts of this quantum computing school. There are impact or outputs that we tried to communicate with the scientific community on how maybe for the low resource countries, how can we try to promote quantum computing for the communities that might not be exposed to such field. So that output was published by the South African Institute of Physics in the 2021 proceedings. On the left, it's the picture of the paper, the abstract, and the details of the topic and everything. Next slide, please. So during these 2 years that we tried to run this quantum computing school program, we have seen some of the challenges that I think we might need to pay more attention to, or maybe there might be some other colleagues from elsewhere who might provide the feedback on how we can handle the challenges. The first one is about gender diversity. We still have these programs being dominated by men, and the key challenge is that we are drawing from the pool that is already biased towards men. Because for the STEM enrollment in Lesotho institutions of higher learning, we still have men being enrolled in higher numbers than females. So it's very difficult to strike the gender balance in such cases. Maybe other programs might be, or other interventions might be necessary to try to achieve that goal of gender balance. The other issue is actually the volatility of Lesotho, especially in the last 2 years of the institutions of higher learning. So organizing events like the quantum computing schools tends to be a bit more problematic, more challenging than if the environment were like very calm and everything, but because we are having this volatility, anything can happen, even if we set the dates for the event. By the time we try to go for the event, we may find that it's during the strike and then it's impossible to go on with the program. So lastly, the government buy-in is still limited at the moment. The government is not participating enough to make this initiative a success at the moment. Maybe with more interactions with the government and the presentations that we provide to them, they might eventually buy in and support the program. I think that was the last slide. Okay, these two pictures are actually, the one bottom left is about the campus, the National University of Lesotho campus. And the one on the right is also that building from the National University of Lesotho, where we hosted the event, the quantum computing events. Thank you very much for the attention.
Thank you, Makamiza. Thank you. And also we should mention how impressive it was. This first project they did in 2020 was one of the only projects we managed to do during that very lockdown period. They managed to hold this in Lesotho. So we were very happy with their efforts in that respect.
Natasha. Thank you. I'm wondering, you mentioned that you had poor attendance in 21. Was online lectures an option? Was it feasible?
At the time, it wasn't feasible because according to the arrangements, we wanted to, it's easier to monitor the hands-on exercises when they are in one room and then we walk around and try to assist than when they are online. And it's not easy to track their participation. We might think we have communicated with them only to find that they were actually not paying attention.
I see, yeah, it's often difficult to do the advertising of these kind of events. But I think, yeah, going forward, we should be able to tackle these things a bit better. And do you have plans to tackle we were just talking about earlier, the gender diversity? Is there any way you think we could work towards getting more female participation in your programs?
At the moment, because we are just drawing from it, the pool which is already biased, it's also a challenge on our part. Maybe we haven't come up with the way forward, but it's something that we want to achieve, even though we don't know how we'll get
there. I think that would be...
In some programs, you may find that we are drawing from 201 female students, so it gets a bit difficult to balance.
Of course. Yeah, it's a problem that is many countries face. Maybe we can do some sort of dedicated cross-physics without frontiers ideas on that in the future. Any other comments or questions? Burning ones, no hands up. Brilliant, thank you so much, Makamiza, for that really nice presentation and these wonderful quantum computing schools that are going on in Lesotho. So we will finish this session and we will have, we will have a shorter 10-minute break. So please, if you're on Zoom, get up and stretch your legs. We don't want you to get hurt from sitting down too long. And we'll meet back at 4:05 time here in Italy for our first session, where we're going to be hearing about Afghanistan, Tanzania, Malawi, Ghana, Nepal, Kurdistan region, Iraq, and Venezuela. So please do join us for that final session. And let's thank Makamiza and all the speakers from the second session. Okay, if everyone has arrived back from their coffees, teas, leg stretching activities. So let's go forward to the third session today. Thank you so much for everyone for staying for the whole session this afternoon. We're going to start off today by hearing from Mr. Baktash Amini. He was here at ICTP not so long ago working on his master's. He's now at the University of Freiburg studying for his PhD. And Baktash will be talking today about building the path towards a physics research community in Afghanistan. Hello, Baktash.
Hello, Kate. Can you hear me?
Yes, we do. Please go ahead.
Can you see my slides?
Yes.
Okay, great. So first of all, hello everyone. And I would like to congratulate the ICTP PWF team on the 10th anniversary of this great program. And it's an honor for me to be here and give a talk in this great event on behalf of my colleagues. And I just saw that many of them are online here, and also most of our students are also joining this program. So hello everyone, and I will give a brief overview on building the path toward a physics research community in Afghanistan. And as Kate already described me, I'm ICTP PWF coordinator and a former lecturer at the Kabul University. So I will begin my talk by introducing the physics departments in Afghanistan. As you can see in this map, we have four physics departments, one in Herat, Balkh, Kabul, Ninghar universities, and we only have undergraduate programs. Unfortunately, we recently in early 2021, Kabul University established an MSc program in nuclear physics, but because of the situation that happened in Afghanistan, unfortunately, this program is going to be canceled, and we will not have MSc program anymore. And before PWF Afghanistan collaboration, we didn't have any research in physics, and the government also did not have any interest in physics, and we didn't have the facility to conduct research in physics, and lecturers, everyone was saturated with teaching. So we didn't have research, and unfortunately, the faculty members also didn't have any contact with the International Physics Society. And fortunately, in 2017, we initiated this PWF Afghanistan collaboration with the intention to have a strong community of physicists in Afghanistan by organizing annual intensive physics school and providing support to students and faculty members, and also to facilitate other collaborations and networks with, such as collaboration of Afghanistan with CERN. So as you will see in the rest of my talk, we have quite good improvements in the situation of physics in Afghanistan because of this PWF Afghanistan collaboration. So how this collaboration began? Actually, in 2017, I represented Afghanistan here in this CERN Sahibi workshop held at Kathmandu University, Nepal. And this workshop was invited by Dr. Archana Sharma. And thanks to her, in this workshop, I met a lot of people. And one of them was Ms. Abba Ali, who is going to represent Nepal this evening. And thanks to Abba Ali, she put me in contact with Stephen Goldfarb, and then he put me in contact with Kate Shaw, and we had this first meeting in August 2017, where we talked about organizing events and activities in Afghanistan. And we had a couple of workshops in Afghanistan back in 2018 and 2019 at Kabul University. You can see in this photo from the left, we have a faculty member, Ahmad Sajjad Nazari, and a local organizer. And then we have here NC Irfani, a professor at IASBS in Iran. She gave us lectures on cosmology. And then Kate Shaw, everyone knows her, and myself, and faculty member Jawad Ahmadi. also a local organizer. So in these workshops, we had lectures delivered by speakers came from ICTP. For example, below here, we have Marco Salario, who was a postdoc at that time at ICTP, and he gave us lectures on special relativity. And next to him, we have Fawad Hassan, who is originally from Afghanistan, and currently he is a particle physics professor at the University of Stockholm, and he gave us lectures on quantum field theory. And on top here, we have Zainab Nazari. She is also originally from Afghanistan, and she was a PhD student at that time, and she gave us lectures on group theory. Besides these lectures, we had a hands-on session where here in these photos, you can see in these two photos, myself and Kate, we were guiding the participants on how to select objects in an event at the ATLAS detector. So, and also apart from these activities that we had with the with the university students, we also had an outreach program with the high school students, where Insia Irfani gave a talk on cosmology in Persian, and most of the participants were females. And also in this outreach program, high school students presented their projects where they made some robotics out of rubbish stuff. Here you can see in this photo, we have Mazharuddin. He is a high school student, and he made this project and presented to us. And here I would like to highlight that during these workshops, and the PWF team also had a meeting with the ministry, where we discussed our future plans and activities in Afghanistan, and they were quite supportive. So here I present two group photos of the two workshops that we had. In the top, it is from the first workshop where we had 200 participants, and in the bottom, we had, in the second workshop, we had 100 participants, and everyone was so excited because of bringing ICTP in Afghanistan. Everyone thanked us, and yeah, I can say that these two workshops can be counted as a starting point of a revolution in physics in Afghanistan, because since then, many things changed in Afghanistan. Our students got inspired to pursue their career in physics and ICTP, PWF, in collaboration with Iranian universities, provided MSc scholarships to our students in Iran. And also more important, two other important points that happened because of these two workshops were that the faculty members established their connections with the International Physics Society, for example, with the physicists at ICTP, and also we established a network of physicists from Afghanistan, and we are going to strengthen these this network, and I believe this network would be vital in the future to keep alive physics in Afghanistan. In 2020, we also had everything was done. We were planning to launch a workshop on condensed matter physics, but unfortunately COVID happened, but and we couldn't do that. In 2021, our government collapsed, and so we couldn't do anything in these 2 years. And for the future, we are thinking to organize a one-year school in the theories of physics. And of course, this project is now at the scratch level, and hopefully we are going to finalize it in a couple of months sooner. So ICTP PWF provided MSc scholarships in collaboration with IASBS in Iran, and also FUM, Ferdowsi Mashhad University. Sarja, since 2019 till 2020, this program provided 20 scholarships at IASBS and one scholarship at Ferdowsi University, Ferdowsi Mashhad University. And here on the top right, this is a group photo of the first batch of our students that benefited from this program. They are at IASBS. From the left, it is Qais Kazemi, Yahya Nazari, Mariam Mohammadi, Mina Zari, professor at IASBS, and also she is organizing this this program with Kate. And then we have Ismail and Javed. So from among all these students, we only have five students who completed their studies back there and at ISBS, and fortunately, three of them obtained PhD positions. In particular, Sharif, who is not available here in this photo, and Javed, they obtained PhD positions in Germany in condensed matter physics, and Mariam, she is here. She obtained a PhD position in Switzerland in optics. And of course, I just saw that most of these students are watching us now. I would like to say that these are our students who are doing their masters in Iran institutions. They are key members of our network. And fortunately, we're going to ask for their help in future to conduct some activities in Afghanistan. Either it could be online or in person. We will think of this. So they are the key members of our network. And also, as I mentioned in my previous slide, because of these workshops, the faculty members established their connections with the ICTP physicists, and it was beneficial in many ways. For example, Professor Bobby Acharya and Fawad Hassan, they helped us in developing the curriculum for the undergraduate program at the Department of Theoretical Physics. And also, When this collapse of the government happened in 2021, Kate Shaw put a lot of effort to find some research opportunities for the faculty faculty members who are females, and she found two research opportunities in Italy for two faculty members. And here I have this photo. It is a historic photo where I first visited ICTP in 2018. And I met a former director of ICTP, Professor Fernando Cubido. And it was there we discussed a lot of things, and we were hoping at that time to achieve a lot of things, and we did actually. And below here, it is my colleague Ahmad Sajjad Nazari and myself at ICTP. We conducted our research, our master's research with the ICTP Atlas group in the support of PWF. And here, this is a photo of ICTP Atlas group, where from the left, it is Muhammad Faraj, who is currently doing his postdoc at ICTP, and then Mikhail Apinamin, my supervisor, and Jacopo, who was a PhD student back at the time, and myself and my supervisor, Professor Bobby Acharya. And here we have Jawad Ahmadi, who is a faculty member, and he's currently at ICTP as a ICTP STEP. He's doing his PhD in condensed matter physics at the Asfahan University. And also, this is a group photo of the CERN Summer School 2019, where I participated. And so I can say, because of this ICTP PWF program, a lot of things happened back there in Afghanistan. If it wasn't because of this program, we would not be able to be in this situation currently in Afghanistan. Although our government collapsed, you are suffering, our people, everyone is suffering, especially, I mean, our young sisters are not allowed to go to schools, to high schools. Our students are suffering at universities because of lack of qualified lecturers. But I'm hoping that if we continue and strengthen this network of physicists that we created, we can keep alive at least the physics community in Afghanistan by supporting students and the faculty members. This brings me to my last slide, where I would like to, where on behalf of the physics community in Afghanistan, especially my colleagues, my students, and also our scholarship holders in Iran, I would like to thank the ICTP and ICTP Physics Without Frontiers program, especially in particular, I would like to thank Kate Shaw and Bobby Acharya for all the efforts that they put throughout these years. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Baktash. Do we have any questions or comments for Baktash? Please.
Thank you for your talk. It's very impressive. You mentioned some hope for the future projects. Would you go lower in the level considering the situation, aim at high schools, or you still plan a higher level of lectures?
Of course, we have been working at the undergraduate level till now. And this, our next project that we are planning is also for the undergraduate level. I mean, it's not really for an undergraduate level, it's for the faculty members because of this chaos that happened in Afghanistan, most of the qualified lecturers fled the country. So the universities had to recruit new people who doesn't have enough qualifications and knowledge to teach those advanced courses, even at the undergraduate level. So we are planning to organize this 1 year school to teach basic theories of physics to this faculty members and also to some undergraduate students who are graduated, BSc graduated students. And of course, we will be happy to hear from PWF and from other colleagues or some other people to organize some programs for the high school levels. And of course, we will do that.
The quick question, did you ever find that English was an issue?
Of course, English is an issue back in our country. That's why we chose Iran, of course, Iran has excellent universities, but also the language was good for our students to pursue their MSc.
So, and we have Ansia Afani, she's Iranian. And in the other school, we had Zainab Fawad, who were Afghan. So most of the lectures would be either in the language Dari, or it would be a little bit of English. Any other quick questions? No? Okay, thank you so much, Baktash, for your talk. It's really inspirational what you and your team are doing in Afghanistan, and I really look forward to working out how we're going to plan more projects for 2023. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, we will move to our next talk by Dr. Daniel Shadrach. He is at the SJUT Institute in Tanzania, and he's going to be telling us about his programs in biophysics in both Tanzania and Malawi. Hi, Daniel.
Hi, Kate. It's nice to meet you. Nice to see many people. I can see a lot of people from the condensed matter section. So allow me to share the screen. I think you can see my screen, right?
Thank you. Yes.
Yes, thank you. I'll be sharing the overview of the biophysics not only in Tanzania and Malawi, but also generally in Africa. So this is a life-changing moment or experience I can call so. So myself, I was an experimentalist, but some years ago, I met Ali Hassan Ali and Professor Quevedo, the former director. They came to Tanzania, and Quevedo said that they will support for my diploma and my PhD at ICTP. And then so it was lucky that I came to ICTP to do both the diploma and the PhD. And then when I was there, I found that our first president has been there and has been several meetings with Abdus Salam. And so I found this quote from him, and I found that I have something to give back to my people back in Africa in general. So I then started conducting and organizing biophysics schools in Africa. So it started in 2018, and it has already trained more than 120 students, including faculties from different countries. And you can see to the right is the map of Africa, indicating where the biophysics school has already reached, or some of the participants, they came from the countries. Since we started in 2018, at least two PhD have already completed in the same field. We have three masters plus they have completed, and others are ongoing. So ideally, the idea started in 2017 when we were in an elevator, me and my former PhD research advisor, Ali Hassan Ali, on the top right corner. Sorry. So we said that after finish my PhD, I should do something in Tanzania. And so then we organized the first school that we conducted at NMIST in Arusha, Tanzania 2018, that we had 28 participants. And then in the next year, 2019, we also conducted, of course, we had two schools. So one of the schools in September and the other was during the big conference MRS, the African Material Research Society. So we organized concurrently and we had a total of 22 participants. So in September, we had 40 participants across the continent. And then in 2020, we had another school. So, but this was a bit challenging because of the outbreak of the COVID, but we managed to do it with many of the professors. Now this time were always talking from teaching from online. So before the COVID, we used to bring many professors, many scientists from ICTP and across the world to come in presence or in physical to give the talk. But for the 2 years, 2020 and 2021, mostly the talk were remotely, except a few who were able to travel mostly from Africa. This year, 2022, we have two schools. One we conducted in January in Malawi, was very exciting. And the other one we have just finished here in Tanzania. So we started by introducing some very basic, say, of drug design and focusing on molecular dynamics simulation as a tool that can help to design and develop drugs. As time goes on, we started introducing other topics like machine learning, free energy, and atomic simulations, molecular dynamics simulation for machine learning. So the idea is how we can use machine learning and atomic simulation to understand how the drug they work and find the drugs. So this are some of the photos in history. So the top one here was the first school, and the second was 2019, was by school with participants from many countries. Here again, some success stories. The top right corner here, the lady, she attended the last two schools, and she was now, she also assisted in doing some tutorials in Malawi in January, and she was lucky. Now she's at ICTP at the moment. She's doing a diploma in the contested matter and statistical physics. The other lady also, she's also in Italy at Milano, but she works with another supervisor from Italy and at Elettra, where she met her supervisors during the school. And this one is, he has already completed PhD and he managed to meet one of the ICTP professor Nicola Celian, and he visited ICTP to complement and finish his PhD studies. So some of the successes that we have is that we have established a strong collaboration and the research network, including student supervision and other students, as I already mentioned. So the ICTP Without Frontiers has already supported and is now is continue to support. Thanks to Katie for supporting. So the last two schools here we conducted in Malawi was really a life also changing experience, because it was the first time to be done in Malawi, and it was a kind of exposure to the students in Malawi. And we agreed that to supervise at least one of the students who was interested, and this one here at the bottom right corner, now I'm supervising. And the top is the last school by Physics Without Frontier we conducted in Tanzania. So what we plan now in the future is that we were planning to establish the African Biophysics Center of Excellence, where many of the faculty members and students then will be trained. much appreciation to Physics Without Frontiers and ICTP in general for the generous support that has been providing us since the inception of the idea. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Thank
Daniel.
You for your attention. Thank you.
Okay, do we have any questions for Daniel on this talk on biophysics and Daniel's journey?
Hi, Daniel, it's Bobby here. Thank you for your presentation and all the efforts you're putting into this great program. So, yeah, I wanted to ask you about this Center of Excellence. Can you tell us more about your ideas as to how you will move towards that?
Yes. So the idea that we have done this now for 5 years, but the idea is that we needed to have a focused place, a place where scientists, young scientists will come and to be trained and learn all this more in detail. So we can also have some programs. So currently in Tanzania, we don't have a curriculum or a program at the university to teach, let's say, biophysics or computational biophysics. So the training that we have been doing, they have been helping the student to do research and to get supervisors. But we focus that if we can have a focus on this and have this excellence, the Center of Excellence will help many of the young scientists in Africa to get solid training.
I see.
Thank you. Yeah, you are welcome for more ideas and suggestions about this, how it should be.
We should talk about it. Also, we should get Ali involved.
Yes, Ali and Eddie Gallonan are involved. They know the idea, of course. I've already chatted to them, but we can continue chatting.
Thank you.
Yes, yeah. Yeah, thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you. Are there any other very quick comments or questions? Okay, well, thank you so much, Daniel, for this really nice talk. And we look forward to seeing what you've got in mind for 2023 as well.
Yeah, for sure.
Brilliant.
For sure. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks
so thank
much.
You.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Okay,
so moving on with our program, we are now going to hear from Dr. Irene Opoku Nitim about training in advanced statistics and programming in Ghana. Irene, are you online? Hiya. Hi, Irene.
Hello. Hi, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you're coming from. So I'm sharing my screen. Okay. So I'm Irene Opoku Nitim from Ghana. I'd like to say a bit about Ghana. So Ghana, officially as a Republic of Ghana, is a country in the West Africa, and it's above the Gulf of Guinea and the Atlantic Ocean to the south, sharing borders with Ivory Coast to the west, Burkina Faso in the north, and Togo to the east. So when it comes to STEM education in Ghana, it's an essential form of education which is needed to improve. So taking into consideration the era that we are in, we all know that we are in the technological era, and it's important for learners and teachers to understand the importance and relevance of STEM education and why we should embrace it. So in 2020, I applied for the Physics Without Frontiers. But due to the COVID, it was postponed. So I got the opportunity to apply again in 2021. And with the help of Kate, we were able to put up a program, which we organized this year in May, from 23rd to 27th of May, where we trained students across various fields. But we trained people in that graduate level because and the master's level. One of the reasons why I chose the topic for the training advanced studies and programming in R was the fact that I myself, though a researcher, also teaches at the University of Ghana. We have the School of Nuclear and Allied Sciences, where I teach research communication and scientific for advanced programming. And I realized most of the students, like, we just have a few students, and when we also have little time to teach this course, so we are not able to go through all the topics that the students are supposed to know. So sometimes when it comes to their research proposal writing, you realize that they lack some skills. So I decided to apply for the Physics Without Frontiers so that if I get, I can also contact the school, then we can organize training for a session of the students. So as I said, the aim of the course was to offer an elaborate introduction to statistics and statistical programming in R, where students will learn to operate R, make plots, fit, assess, and interpret a variety of basic statistical models. So we had this training. We had a lot of volunteers who came on board, my colleagues, because I told them we just had some small funding from ICTP, Physics Without Frontiers. So I needed them to come on board for us to train the students. So some of these volunteers, we had Dr. Morris Arthur with the Nuclear Power Institute of the Ghana Atomic Energy. We also have Dr. Philip Diatenya. We had Dr. Joseph Berman Tando. We had Dr. Christiana Oduma Hood. We have Mr. Franz Kwashi, Dr. Theophilos Adrako, and Dr. Oredu Jampo. And they all came together for us to organize this program. So from the screen, you can see a session of the students with the volunteer, that's Dr. Morris Arthur, taking students through the programming course. And all this picture shows a section of students and the volunteers interacting. And I was excited. So one of the students started by saying he never knew like learning R was this easy. I would have said earlier. So I realized if this program had started earlier or we had organized in previous years, it would have a lot of the students. And some people didn't even know about the opportunities that ICTP has to offer. So through this program, we were able to educate them, able to tell them some of the opportunities that they can get through ICTP. And they were really happy. And I know from next year, a lot of more people are going to apply for the ICTP, so the diploma courses and other opportunities that ICTP offers. So what were the impacts on the students? Most students at the end realized look so fulfilled and happy to be part of the training course. As I said, the training in statistics in our school is not really, they don't really get time to go through every aspect. So this was really intense. They got to understand it really well. And it was practical. I mean, we had practicals throughout from day one to the final day. So they're really happy. And most of the students said about their program in which they had more days for the training. But unfortunately, it was just a one-week program. And we promised them that we hope to make it an annual program so that a wider group of people also have the opportunity to join. And as I said, they asked volunteers to have another session and asked us that we make the program an annual one. So you can see the photograph shows the first on my left shows the Director General of the Ghana Atomic Energy, who also supported us and came out to support us on the final day, gave out certificates to participants. And the second picture shows our Deputy Director General of the Ghana Atomic Energy also came in to support us and help us in giving out certificates to our students. So what does the future hold for us? So as I said, we want to make this training an annual training program where we'll be collaborating with the ICTP, PWF, University of Ghana, and the Ghana Atomic Energy Commission. And we also hope to extend this program to a lot more people within the country, because when we announced the program, we had a lot of applicants across the country. And because of accommodation and also for travel's sake, most people were not able to join us. So few people were able to come out from other regions to join because of accommodation. So we want to make it so that if we get more funds, we'll be able to extend to other people from other parts of the country. Thank you.
Thank you, Irene. Thank you. That's a really wonderful talk. You've done some really wonderful program. Okay, well, I can open the floor to a question. I'll just check. You can raise your hand on Zoom if you'd like to ask. Maybe I can just ask while we're waiting. I'm interested to know, so you taught these statistical techniques and R programming. How did you work with the technical side? Did you have any trouble uploading or getting students to access software, or did you use, say, notebooks through a browser? How did you manage the technical side of things?
Yeah, so with the technical side, we had a very good technical team. So I think on the first day, before the program, we asked the students to install the R on their laptops before they come. But those who were not able to do that, I think the first 2 hours, we helped all of them to install. So throughout, aside that, we didn't have any issues with students installing the R on their laptops. Because most people, we ask them to install before they get there. And I think about 90% installed on their laptop before attending the program. So the 10%, when we said the program, those who had not installed, the technical team helped them to install it on their laptops.
Perfect. Yeah, and I guess that means they can also go on to practice more programming techniques after the course as well. It's nice if it's on the laptop. Yeah. Do you have any other questions for Irene, Bobby?
It's Bobby here. It was interesting. Oh, thank you for your presentation, Irene, by the way. I think it's a really fantastic program. You mentioned that, you know, some of the students didn't know about the diploma program. So did I take it then that you did some advertising of it?
Yes, I did. I think throughout the 5 days that we had the program, at the end of every session, we talked about the opportunities at ICTP. So the diploma, every program like that is available at ICTP, we were able to let them know. And more people realize, oh, they have these opportunities. So next year, we are all going to apply to ICTP into one or two of their programs.
That's fantastic. That's really great. Thank you. And we look forward to continuing our partnership.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks, Irene. Yes, we should definitely talk soon. Thank you so much for your presentation and joining us today. Appreciate it.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, so next we have Miss Abba Ellie, who's going to be talking to us about fostering physics in Nepal. Hi, Abba.
Hi, Kate. It's lovely to see you all here. So I'm going to share my screen. Can you see my slides?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, great. So yes, we've had a long partnership with ICTP and it's wonderful to be here talking about it. I'm going to tell the framework of how we worked over the last decade. So it's called Taking High Energy Physics to High Altitudes because we work mostly in Nepal. Particularly in Kathmandu, but some areas out of Kathmandu also from time to time. So it all began when I met Kate after joining the Atlas Experiments Outreach and Education Group. We had an idea of reaching out to different countries, and the country that I knew best was Nepal because I was from there. And so we wrote out to different universities, and in 2013, me and Suyog, we went to Nepal and we held a test event to see if there was interest and how we could possibly go about it. And when we returned to Geneva, because we were working at CERN, we created a framework that has held the test of time. And we've used that framework for the past 10 years in all the events that we've held in Nepal. So every time we go, we organize events based on a three-pronged approach. First, we try to reach out to university physics students, and then we try to reach out to high school science teachers and students, and we always try to have a public component, which is usually general public, which is public facing, and policymakers, which are people who make decisions in the country. So, okay, let me see. So the first one, which is university physics students, we reach out to undergrads and grads. This was done in help with a lot of help from the people on the ground, especially Trieste University and Kathmandu University. I'd like to give out to Raju Dai. I think I saw him here, if he's here. Rajendra Dai and Deepak Dai. They have been instrumental in helping us get students who are very interested in preparing them for the master classes. These courses for the students, the physics students, were usually consisted of lectures, which is the basic general overview of particle physics, hands-on sessions where they could find particles, they could discuss, there were different kinds of hands-on sessions where they could actually interact with data from the LHC. And then we had discussions, and these discussions differed on what we felt that the students needed. So we would often do a survey after or before the course. And based on the survey that the students submitted, we would say, okay, this year we should go with a career session because the students want to know more about what the opportunities they could pursue post their education outside or in Nepal. The other possible discussions we've had is just a basic one about how to write applications for different summer schools or how to prepare the CVs, how to submit to journals, different discussion sessions based on things like that. So the other component that we always used were high school students and science teachers. We understood while we were working at CERN that there was a high school teachers training program, and we wanted really to bring some on board. And this is what we did with the funding that we got from ICTP, was also try to have events in high schools in different parts of the country. So we went to Nawa Asha Griha in Kathmandu, we went to Siangza's district. And this particular event in Siangza was based after the first high school teacher had come to CERN, trained, returned, and we had a high school teachers training session in this village for 10 different schools. And it was wonderful because it wasn't just high school. We had like students from lower classes sneaking into the class because they thought we were having so much fun in there. And then the other one, the one in Sindhili in 2015, this one was supposed to be also for high schools, but you know, the whole village ended up because they were all so curious and they wanted to know. And there's so many people in the classroom, like it's dark, as you can see. And the third component that we always tried to include was facing the general public, like who in the wider population could we reach out to and say, hey, we should be talking about science because eventually we will need your support. So again, these events varied based on what we thought. Now this we did not do surveys on, but basically we thought what we could do, what was within our reach, and also what would fulfill a possible gap that existed. So the first year we did a public outreach was the picture on the lower right, which was a film screening session of Particle Fever. And then we had a discussion session, and this was hugely popular. We had almost 500 people on the waiting list. People were showing up with blankets and mats to sit on the ground so they could just, you know, be inside and listen to the physicist, because we had a panel discussion afterwards. And then we went to Pokhara this was more a goodwill building outreach session where physicists from CERN had gone to different parts of Nepal and had built children's homes or schools and things like that. So we wanted to build goodwill there and also reach out to the students saying, hey, you know, we care about you. And we went to a home in Pokhara with some merchandise from CERN, and they just loved the Atlas 3D viewers. On the left was a more, I would say, a landmark event where after having worked in Nepal for 3 to 5, I think almost 6 or 7 years doing these outreach events, we realized that always we would have to ask, okay, where are the women? Where are the girls? Where are the female professors? You know, even if there was a female professor, we often didn't see them involved in the organization or the process of creating the event on the ground. So to fill this gap, we created a public event that was actually a whole day. And one of the components was called Women in Science. And we invited scientists, female scientists in Nepal from different institutions. And we just had a discussion, which was hugely, I would say, energetic and very invigorating. And there were, I think, a lot of awareness later about what possibly could be done. So the third part, second public-facing event were outreach to policymakers. So often we have policymakers in place in developing countries who do not necessarily know how to move forward in science, though they are very interested. And so what we need to do, we figured, is that we need to create partners within the government so they could then reach out to us when they needed expertise or when they needed some kind of advice or suggestions. So we would go, every time we went to Nepal for these outreach events, we would have a meeting with either the Ministry of Education or the Ministry of Science, and then we would come back to CERN. Then we would go visit the embassy there and then build a rapport with the ambassador. So every time there was a visiting dignitary in Switzerland, then we would invite them to come and visit CERN. And out of this effort, which took many, many years, like 8 to 9 years, we finally had Nepal sign a ICA, which is the International Cooperation Agreement between CERN and the Ministry of Science and Technology. And in the picture here on the with Fabiola Gianotti, who's the DG of CERN, you see the ambassador of Nepal back then. And he was very, very supportive and very instrumental in helping us achieve what we later went on to achieve, which is the president of Nepal came to visit CERN, and she was very interested and invited the director of international affairs and various other scientists to Nepal. And we also had their support and the support of Kathmandu University, the support of Thribhuvan University, and CERN, seeing that how much effort we put in over the years, asked us to organize the first South Asian High Energy Physics Instrumentation Workshop in Kathmandu. And that's what we ended up doing in 2017. And it was, I must say, it's been an event that's continued, and we were very proud to have started it. So the next slide is, because of the ICA and all the work we've done, all the relationships we've built, and all the interest we've heard from the people on the ground, we realized that there was a gap in Nepal that could be filled with things that were existing at CERN, but not necessarily being used, which is the supercomputer. So in CERN, the supercomputer is only used until they are, you know, they after a certain time, they become obsolete for what CERN scientists do. But these are perfectly capable, very powerful supercomputers, and they often donated to countries who want to use them. And so Nepal was in this situation where they could not actually crunch their own data, like they could not crunch their own data in a way that they would like. So they would often send their data out to other countries. So what we did was we worked with the government, we worked with the universities, we worked with the embassy in Geneva, and we worked with the different departments inside CERN to make this happen. And the supercomputers are currently housed in Kathmandu University. And the team there have been instrumental in training many, many students, like hundreds and hundreds of students and a lot of faculty, in how to use this for, just different kinds of academic disciplines, not just physics. And they've gone on to publish many, many papers and journals that are very prestigious and respected. So the future becomes the present, because when we started out, we did not realize what effect or impact we would have. We only knew there were certain gaps that existed, and we had the resources and the ability to fill those. And I'm only putting some of the pictures here. So on the left is Bishnu Lamsal, who was the first high school teacher to attend the CERN science teacher training. And he was the one who was instrumental in later going on and creating high school teachers events in the different schools in Xiangzhe. And currently, even when we go back to Nepal, we meet up with him, and eventually we get to talk to many, many other high school teachers. And we've also met the boards of different schools who are very interested. It's just that now we realize we have a limit on the capacity and the bandwidth that we're able to operate in, because there's so much interest. The second teacher is the one who came from Xiangzhe. He was the principal of Sindhuli. He was the principal of that school, and he came to CERN. He got trained and he went back again. Similarly, very instrumental, very, very energetic, very enthusiastic, has gone on to change the way science is taught in the schools today, in the villages. And on the right, you will see a couple of students who were attending the outreach events, the CERN summer schools that we organized for undergraduate and graduate students. So on the left is Ishan. He was the first one, and he's currently a PhD student at Göttingen in Germany. On the right of Ishan, you'll see Santosh, who's currently also a PhD student at Southern Methodist University. And below is Rami. But besides them, we had many, like we had almost one or two students every year since we started outreach programs. We had a teacher almost every year after we started this way of organizing our events. And on the right, Roshan Joshi, who is currently a PhD student at Ohio State University, he sent me this quote, which I thought was very important, because he said, apart from learning about particle physics and research and making connections, the events that we organize, it helped me understand the importance of outreach programs. And Roshan himself has gone on to organize many, many outreach programs in Nepal. He organized one with Deer Walk, which included theoretical components, and we had virtual visits to CERN, and we've always sort of had virtual visits to CERN, but he was able to do a lot of things with very little support from us. So what is actually making me really happy is that all the events that we've done, now we can sort of give them to the younger people so they can continue it in their own capacities with their own perspectives in ways that we might not have been able to do. And one of the offshoots actually of the outreach programs was Milky Way Network, which currently operates in Pokhara, and they work more in astrophysics, but they've been doing an amazing job also over the years. So now I've taken a backseat from all the events. I only offer advice and suggestions. And there are a lot of other people who've put in proposals that have been picked by ICTP to fund. And the current one is Holographic Himalaya by Kiran. I think I saw him online also. And this is a really interesting event, and it's not something that would have fallen within the frameworks that we had created, but it's very, very important, I think. It is a long-term event. It takes place online for 6 months and involves a lot of students and a lot of teachers to talk about the idea of quantum information aspects of space-time and matter. And on the right, you will see in an event, another proposal put in by another person who's been involved in quite a few of our outreach programs before, but he was also a graduate student who attended CERN while studying at the University of Chicago. And he's currently working with marginalized communities in Nepal, in places that we actually had no reach to. And he's there because he's from there. And he's organizing a science outreach program for girls from these marginalized populations and give them the tools. I mean, not just organize an education event, but give them the tools and help them understand how science works, what are the opportunities that exist out there for them, and how they could actually try to tap into the resources that are currently available online and through and have them interact with scientists too virtually. I think these are all amazing efforts, and I honestly could not have imagined that this would be the outcome. And I'm really, really happy to be here. And thank you so much, Bobby and Kate and ICTP and everyone who's supported. And thank you to the people who are now putting in projects from Nepal. I hope this enthusiasm and energy continues a lot longer.
Thank you, Abba. Thank you, Abba. Yes, Nepal project has been going on, I think, for most of the 10 years of Physics Without Frontiers, and it's been incredible. What a lot of impact you've shown. We actually have a Nepalese student that's at our ICTP diploma program.
Hello, Ava.
Hi.
I think you remember me. We met back in the 2018 when you were organizing the Physics Without Frontier program at Trivandrum University. And I have been selected for the postgraduate diploma program here at ICTP. And I just want to thank you all for doing such hard work. And I think I'm not wrong when I say that most of the students who have been part of the Physics Without Frontier program and got the opportunity to be in different universities and different places, I'm telling thank you from all of them. I think I'm not wrong when I say that. And please continue your work. And I'm very inspired by this work. Thank you.
Thank you. This is what makes my day. Thank you so much. To actually have people come up and say, yeah, you know what you did, this is what we're doing now because of whatever you guys said, you know. And it's lovely. Congratulations on making it to ICTP. And it's just lovely to see young people come up and pursue an interest, their interest and passion in science.
Yeah, it's fantastic. Any question or comment to ABBA? I just wanted to highlight actually what I really love about your programs is the focus that you do give towards policymaking and outreach. And I think that's something a lot of our other programs would like to look at doing a little bit more. Obviously the training and transferable skills and the mentoring of undergraduate students is really important. I love that you take that time, and I know that you probably need time to do that, to do public events, outreach events, and access policymakers, because you can see the impact that your programs had due to that work you've done. So that's been great. And thank you very much for that.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for your support, Kate. Continued for so long. I think you're the longest running partner of our events.
Yes. And I wonder if Kieran is online today, if he wanted to say a few words, because his new project, which just started, is an online journal club for students in Nepal called Holographic Himalaya. Kieran, do you want to say a couple words about that? It's so exciting. I love it. I want to join. I barely understand the topics myself.
Hi. Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, yeah. Kieran.
Yeah, okay, so thank you. So it was so nice listening to Eva talking about what she did in Nepal. And I completely agree with you that we should also give some pressure to the policymakers in Nepal, because they are the one who will at the end do something. I mean, they can make a bigger impact at the end. And regarding our project, like this Holographic Himalayan, it was supposed to be an online journal club. And we have like around 30 students, and it will be, so we will train them to how to do research and so on. And these topics are now like very hot in theoretical physics. So, I mean, yes, it's interesting. So personally, it's interesting for me as well. And I'm very excited.
Yeah, it looks absolutely amazing. You. It's quantum information of space, matter and time, something like this. Yeah, it looks fantastic, and good luck with that with your students, Kieran, and thank you very much to ABBA for her talk. Thank you. So we have just two talks left. I can't believe it's going so fast. Our next talk is by Mr. Musin Al-Jaff. So he's at Garmanian University in the Kurdistan region in Iraq. And we have a few different projects going on in the Kurdistan region in Iraq. But Musin will be talking, his talk is called Grasping at Straws, Cosmology, High Energy Physics and Medical Physics in the Kurdistan region in Iraq. Hi, Musin.
Hi, Kate. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
And can you see my screen?
Yes, it's sharing. Thank you.
Okay, perfect. So first of all, it's a really great pleasure to be here. I'm very thankful to be invited. My name is Mohsen. I come from Kurdistan region of Iraq. I represent for many, many volunteers and localized in Kurdistan region. And I also want to, before starting the talk, I want to thank and appreciate the work of all those who are behind the scenes. I mean, the secretary staff in ICTP, Professor Bob and Kate Shaw, all those who have participated in this project and initiate this project. I believe this is something really bigger than thinking about oneself, but caring about others. So I really appreciate that. And this is really need to be appreciated. So, of course, all those who are doing these projects in different regions in the world, because I see that we are having a lot of projects from different regions. And this is what brings back to the title of my talk, Grasping at Straws, because I believe PWF and the original mission of ICTP has been like grasping at straws, which means trying to find a way where other things doesn't work in order to succeed. I think in at least in my case in Kurdistan region, these projects and this initiative was something like that for us. So let me just introduce the my region. Iraqi Kurdistan or Kurdistan region is an autonomous region in the north of Iraq. There are three provinces, main provinces, Duhok, Sulaymaniyah, and Erbil. These are the picture of the cities, and there are academically, there are 12 private universities and 15 public university. This is a map. Duhok is here, Erbil, and Sulaymaniyah. So let me come to the, sorry. Okay. Let me come to the motivation. The motivation comes from the need, based on my observation, all the friends I have and all those who are aware of the scientific situation in this region. We see a lot of physics in the West is the students who don't have any venue to pursue their degrees in fundamental physics. We focus on fundamental physics because we see other fields like applied physics and material science. There are research, quite research about that, and there is graduate degrees and programs. But for the fundamental physics like cosmology and particle physics, unfortunately, the education stops after bachelor degree. There is no programs, there is no experts, and that's what we really lack of in this region. We don't have experts in order to have programs and finally students and experts again. So in back in 2017, I was emailing Steven Weinberg, and I was asking for advice. Like, I like these fields, but what to do? What kind of advice can you give me? And he was actually confirming the same problem. He was saying that in these regions, the government in these countries, they don't support for fundamental physics, and they only care about the fields that has immediate application. So you either better to work on theory either abroad or just inside. And so that's where I started to go abroad, and finally I find some position in China. I was lucky, and the beginning of this story was ICTP was starting from Tsinghua University. When I was participating in a conference, I met Nima Arkani, and I was somehow complaining like it's difficult for the student from my region, at least, to get to the top universities. And he was immediately said, try ICTP. By the time I knew that there is something like ICTP, but I didn't know the mission, the goal, the outreach goal especially. So I applied, and I was admitted to this summer school back in 2019. And then I met Baktash, and we had a small chat. He was talking about PWF. And that was really fascinating to me. So I immediately went to the director, Professor Fernando, the former director. And actually he was really nice to me, and he talked about the program. I liked the idea. And he said, I remember quite well, he said, we will put Kurdistan region in our priority. And he said, email Kate. So that's where I found Kate and emailed him. She was not there at the time, but we had emails, and then we started thinking about the project. The first project was in 2019. We had a few months to prepare, but collecting the speaker was very difficult in the beginning. I found one of my colleagues in China, and also Daniel Grigoris, who was an Italian physicist there. There was in total three speakers, around 60 students participated, and these are the pictures. We had same session live from the LSC. And actually it was really, really, I saw many, many motivated students there. They were really excited by seeing the real scientists talking about the real science. And we gave basic lectures about the cosmology and particle physics. And of course we couldn't in 3 days cover all the topics, but the idea is to just motivate and show them that it can be done, and if they want to pursue, this is the direction. This is a team, two of these people, these two young students, now they are pursuing their master's degree in China, and here is Kate meeting with a faculty member. The second project was back in 2020, September. This time we had a lot of time to prepare. Luckily, we got some funding also from the University of Gurmia. I mean, Salahuddin, that's the university in capital city. We had a lot of good international speakers because we had time to prepare and invite them, including Sean Carroll from Caltech and Lavinia Heisenberg from ETH Zurich. We had master classes in these events. We had theoretical lectures on the basics of cosmology, inflation, particle physics, phenology. This is a team, actually, for this event, as I said, we were really prepared. We had a lot of volunteers to help us. So that was really nice for us. And this year in February, we had a workshop for the students of Gurmia University. It was about the LHC and the importance of LHC and how physicists find particles in LHC. We had two local liaisons, and including myself, which is the third. We had a session from CERN and also two theoretical lectures about the basics of LHC and particle physics. This event, this is the last event I'm talking about, which is happening right now in Trieste University. It's not in the fundamental physics, but it's in medical physics. There are three international speakers from Italy, also in partnership with some Italian hospital. You see that the team has arrived and we have a lot of participants from the university because the students from this university, they are medical physics students. So the program really fits their curriculum. About the impact, I just want to be quick because I think I don't have so much time. The idea was not to teach all the details to the students, but to show them the cutting edge of science and motivate them to find their direction in fundamental physics. And also we brought those people, those students who share the same dream, who like to pursue their degrees or studies in fundamental physics. Of course, we have now, right now, a lot of liaisons and volunteers in different universities that will help us to organize more events. Actually, for example, in this last event, I was not participating in anything because now the project is one is food and we have different volunteers in different universities. So I think that's the most important thing because it's like a chain reaction, starting from one person or two person originally from ICTP, and now we have a lot of volunteers in different universities. Also, we created an online group for support those who want to seek career and study abroad by guiding them through the application process and providing them with opportunities. These are some quotes from the students. For example, Noshirwan Mustafa, which he was one of the participants. He said, I am studying a master's degree in cosmology and gravity right now. Daban said that the school gave me hope and dreams of becoming a real scientist. And Rej Naher, which she was one of the female participants, she said that it was a scientific joy that in many years of university studies, I didn't experience. So because most of the time in these universities, it's just about textbooks and classical lectures. To see real science and real scientists, it's difficult here. So the last word I want to say that about the future plans and what we really need right now, as I said, we need to put the project on its foot. So meaning that we should have more volunteers and speakers in different universities so that they can do it by themselves. And also we want to organize more events in not just in high energy physics and cosmology, but in other science fields like what we did recently in medical physics. My last home is to do some projects in Rojava, which is a Kurdish part or northern Syria. This region are really in war and in conflict. Right now, some terrible bombing happening by Turkey. And I know some universities there that their students, they don't have the same privilege as students that are in Kurdistan region. So if I find contact, I will try to, we will try, not it's more than me. We will try to find some ways to help them by doing some projects. Thank you so much. And sorry, I think I passed the time.
No, thank you so much, Muhsin.
Appreciate it.
Really incredible amount of work you guys have done in various different universities. And yeah, at the moment we have the medical physics school going on at this moment, which is really exciting. Okay, so do we have any questions from Zoom or from the room? Okay, Bobby.
Yeah, I hope the medical physics school is going well. Do you think this is something that may be repeated in the future or in some form?
You mean the regarding the medical school?
Yeah.
Well, I think now we have volunteers and people who can write and apply for this project. We have only one program in Kurdistan region who provides undergraduate medical physics, and that's in this university. So I think in the future, now they have a network in Italy speakers. If you have the speakers, then organizing this school will be easy. So I think volunteers that I know, they will repeat these courses, maybe long courses, because as far as I know, even the title of the program is medical physics, but they don't have so much courses, special courses in this field. It's basically the same physics, but this is really different that we have done for them.
Yeah, I think it's amazing. I mean, overall, it's amazing what you and your colleagues are doing. Thank you.
Thanks so much for you too.
Thank you. And I was going to ask Ms. Sin. Yeah, we started to talk to universities in Rajava. I wonder if you've managed to make contact with them again and if we've got some ideas for the next steps.
Well, I have some people there, from Rojava universities and Kobani University. But what we really, first of all, the region is not stable. Sometimes bombing happens, wars happen, threats happen. But I think the first problem that we are facing is the language barrier. The students they study either in Kurdish or Arabic. So we need some people who can speak Arabic and do physics. Recently, we did some help without, the context of ICTP. There was a student, master students who needed some supervisor. We find some supervisor for him, but there is always some strict requirement and also include the politics. It's kind of sensitive these regions, so the people who help should be also careful. But we will try. I am in contact with them and. We will try to find some ways. They need a lot. They are much more in need than the people. This university there. The university is not recognized by the central government.
Of course, that makes things doubly complicated. Okay, thank you so much, Ms. Zin. You're doing fantastic work. And
thank you so much. It was a pleasure.
Thanks so much for joining and sharing with us.
Appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Okay, we are on to our last talk of the day. So this is from Dr. Arturo Sanchez. He was an postdoc here at ICTP, and he's going to be talking to us about pursuing physics and opportunities in Venezuela. So we do several activities, quite different things, and Arturo has kindly agreed to summarize quite a lot of that for us.
Hello.
Hi, Arturo.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Excellent. First, nice to see you again, guys. Congratulations. I hope that we can continue doing many of these projects. Just a few seconds. Again, yes, I was there at CTP, and I just can be a little bit selfish right now and tell you that all these projects also have been really, really amazing to do it. A lot of fun. Obviously, interact with the students is always quite refreshing, and you learn a lot. So. I saw all the different projects during this 3-4 hours that you have been here, and all have the same mission, obviously, similar way what I will present you here about Venezuela. Reina spoke also a couple of hours before me about some of this effort. So this is a compendium of the other project, let's say. And so I will start with some of these. One of the more recent, in fact, this was this year, at the beginning of this year, we did a physics school. It's called Brain Game, and I will come back about this brain game during the presentation, but the scope of this school was essentially invite at different universities in Venezuela, and anybody else essentially in Latin America, as again were mentioned by Reina in several of the projects that wanted to join to these 2 weeks school, where we also give some support thanks to the ICTP and the Physics Without Frontier program to some students to have resources, for example, to get some internet connection to, most of the students are connecting from their own home. These have been also, as many of the projects that you already show, a common after during the pandemic and even before in some cases in Venezuela due to the particular situation of the country. But anyway, it was a very, very nice event. We managed a lot of, at this point, again, since I am talking about a very recent event with respect to all the others, we were better and better in how to call the attention of the student and how to propagate this information through social media to, you know, to let the people know what was the schedule, the person that we were talking, what was about, being sure that it was in the hours for the different countries that were participated. Most of the instructors were people in, also in Venezuela, professors in Venezuela, with some help for us. I have to mention, for example, right now I am talking from Switzerland. Most of the people that we will mention here as the organizer of the events are outside the country, as many of you maybe in your cases, but all the focus have been in engaged not only the students, but also the professionals in the different universities. And this is why you used to see a lot of logos here in all this presentation. So it was a very nice event, was very successful. We managed to engage these people again for 2 weeks, something that is quite difficult sometimes, especially because obviously the people needed, especially the student had to be there. They needed to make a minimum about of these different courses of these different subjects in order to also get the certificate of the participation in the school. So we, without going to the details, we have participants for the main universities of the country, but we also make a big effort to call students from the smaller university or the university we didn't reach yet during all the different programs that we have done during the past year. So it was quite balanced also in terms of numbers is females and males and in something that is quite positive, obviously all the time, but I must say also a nice feature of region for example, in Venezuela in general, in Latin America. So it's nice to see that. Another project I wanted to bring to this meeting is the Physics Reboot Venezuela. So it was mentioned also in the presentation by Reina that some of we have been doing this since several years already. I lost the count, maybe 6-7 years already, even more with Cebal if included. And some of these students at that time, they grow, they are very good, they become professional, master student, PhD now, and doing research. And some of these projects now are managed by these people. So it's really also cool to see how the evolution of these people, obviously, in 99.9% of their own effort, of their own capacity, but also with this interaction that we have with Physics Without Frontiers. And this is one of the examples here. And Reboot is a program made or running by most of students from the Universidad Simón Bolívar in Venezuela. But as you can see, all these different logos means all the different people that they invite. Also the different institutions where the different young people now is studying or even now even doing research. So some of these faces are very familiar for us because are people who have been with us in different programs through Cevale to Physics Without Frontier during this year. So this is also quite a nice program because they try to enlarge the amount of subjects that are teaching these different programs. So for example, they're talking about computational science, something that we also do, but quite important soft skills. So how to write a good curriculum, how about the management of the time, the management of the stress and these kind of skills that are also quite important in order to have a successful career. But all going all the way to quantum information, quantum technology, and obviously the networking that is a common thing in all the different programs. So try to connect the students with other students, with teachers, with professors, with opportunities like the different programs that you have mentioned that is happening during the in ICTP at CERN and many other facilities around the world. So again, they have these multiple programs where participants, as you can see, the program is mainly online. They have a guest lecture, so people who is expert in a particular area that give you some lectures. And again, not only in hard science, quantum computing, but also in some other capacity and other tips and tools, and obviously the networking that is quite important essentially for the students in order to continue their studies and their careers. Another nice project, and also that was mentioned before in Reina's presentation, so not to repeat too much here, but that Daniel, and together with other people, again, in this case, for Universidad de Los Andes, that is also our alma mater for all of us here, started to run also online and very successfully, also inviting people, expert in the area, to go for what we call advanced lecture in theoretical physics. So the subjects go, again, all the way from quantum field theory, computational Turing, high-energy physics, but also quantum gravity, string theory. So really a very large amount of expertise has to be brought in this very nice project for Daniel and their colleagues in order to show and to engage the students with subjects that we didn't touch in other physics with a frontier program. Essentially, because we don't have this kind of expertise, and so have been very cool to see how others have been expanding the same effort with more or less the same mechanism. You see these only online events, this kind of school, this engagement, there is a lot of effort put also in the social media in order to call the attention of the people, to call the attention of the students and the researchers that will talk with us. So I mentioned before that this brain game was part of the organizer of the school, but there is a particular program that we created thanks to, again, to Physics Without Frontiers and the ICTP in general, to in order to also support the professors in the universities in Venezuela, public universities in Venezuela. So in 2019, we run a call, in this case, to help professors that have been and still are there on the ground, on the universities, teaching all the different courses, even after all the different difficulties on the country. So without going into details, as all the different countries have been participating here, the conditions are not always optimal to teach, for to say in a nice way. So this program was focused mainly in the professors, and was really interesting to see also how this bring together the application of professors to show what they are doing in the country, to show what they would like to continue doing it in the different classes and different even extra things. Like, you know, most of them also have students doing some different theses, for example. So we run the program a couple of times. These are, for example, the first four fellows of the Physics Without Frontier Brain Game program in Venezuela. Two of them from ULA, one from the Universidad Simón Bolívar, and one from the Universidad Central de Venezuela. And we run the program again the year after. It was more, we decided to try to split that resources into more professor, into more teacher assistant that did the application. So these are the second group of fellows that were awarded for this brain game. So there's this fellowship, you can call it like this, where together with them, and thanks to them, that we organized that school that I presented at the very beginning. So have been always this connection of let's keep helping the people that is still doing all this huge effort in the country, and also obviously getting involved in all the different programs. So one of these is the school that I mentioned that was quite successful in a big part because they were the not all, but a big portion of the lecturers during that school. So more another program that was very nice and very nice project and a small project, but quite value for us. We make a small master thesis project with Physics Without Frontiers also, where we were running different, essentially we have different master students during those years, and we proposed Physics Without Frontiers if they can essentially be putting a single umbrella and a small project so they can show to the program, to ICTP, what they have done during their thesis. So we have a little workshop with some of these students, some presenting in English, some of them presenting in Spanish, and thank for that, because one of the main reasons why doing all this is also that they have this exposure, this opportunity to explain what they are doing, and you know, and to have this feeling of make a presentation that is obviously quite relevant for what we're doing. And I want to finish with a very last project that we run. These are the presentations of the defense, the thesis defense of a couple of students in the previous program. So one of the missions that we wanted to accomplish here with all the people that we prepared in this slide is to try to give you an idea of the continuity of all the different projects and how we try to continue mentoring, continue tracking the student, and how those students became, in fact, now teachers, now lecturers, now the organizer of new projects. And I wanted just to finish with a very last project. In this case, we use some of these different classes, especially about computing, data analysis, programming, and we run also a very nice program in Honduras. It's part of the region of the world that we wanted to touch with Physics Without Frontiers, so the Central America part. And we have a lot of success here also. It's a little bit different because most of the students are not physics students, they are engineering students. So we had to adapt all the material to what they really, what they see most, let's say, what can be more practical in their careers. So this is my very last example of how we have been trying to expand not only the program, but also how we can reuse this material that we know is useful in other areas and try to expand also the target audience that we would like to reach. And this is, yes, my last slide. Thank you so much again. Sorry, Kay, as usual, I tell you 1-2 minutes, Bobby, but it has been a pleasure every second.
Thank you. Thank you, Arturo. Yes, you had covered quite a lot of different projects from various things we've been doing in Venezuela over the years. Okay, any questions? Yes.
Thank you. Oh, okay. Hi, good afternoon.
Hi.
Well, first of all, congratulations for your projects, your presentation, and also thank you for your leadership. I recognize that Physics Without Frontiers should also be Physics Without Borders. And I live in Cartagena, Colombia. And recently, our two countries opened the borders after six years of having closed them. Yeah. And I was wondering, what are your comments about this new opportunity, or going forward, what do you think can be done between the two countries, since we are also Caribbean countries?
But is that your name? I didn't hear your name.
My name is Javier Montoya. I work at the University of Cartagena.
Cora Montoya. Yes, Javier. No, I mean, it's really nice that you bring the subject of Colombia and Venezuela, because I can't give you a random number, but a very big portion of many of these programs have been in collaboration with you guys. So Colombia have been instrumental in many of these things, in many cases without knowing it, but in a positive way. For example, I am from the Táchira, and just to give you a bit of context to the rest of the people here, is one of the states in the border that Javier was just mentioned right now. So every time, especially, for example, when we go to this, we went to these round trips, I was the person who used to go to Venezuela. And the only way the easiest way to go was to walk that border that wasn't closed during all the years that we did that program. So, and it's still, you need to walk. There is no only way to pass that. So in a positive way, because this is the last presentation, but in a realistic way, we have been working even with that difficulties. So I think that even boosts a little bit more these kind of programs. Many of our professors, students are studying and living in Colombia, and they have been, so the cooperation have been wonderful. We work like that border didn't exist, and we hope that we will continue doing like this. So hopefully will be easier. The movement of people will be easier, but we have been a very good partnership. And thank you for that in your country.
Thank you very much. And what about organizing one of these next events, perhaps on the other side of the border? Would you come?
Absolutely. I mean, I am a little bit farther, but we can make it and there. It's always a pleasure to be there. It's a good excuse to visit Colombia and to visit Venezuela.
Great. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Okay, any last comments, questions? Okay, thank you, Arturo. That was a fantastic talk, and thank you for covering also the boot camps and all the exciting things people have been organizing in Venezuela. So this is the end of the session. Thank you so much for staying and listening to all these talks. I hope you find them as inspirational and fascinating as I have. Bobby?
Is that all you wanted to say, Kate, or do you have some last remarks? No, I just wanted to say for those of you that are still here, first of all, thank you to everyone for their excellent, but putting so much effort into making these presentations. But, you know, to see, to get this overview after 10 years, it's really amazing what people can achieve when they have these goals in mind. And I want to thank everyone that was has contributed to all of these wonderful projects that have had so much impact in inspiring and giving opportunities to young budding scientists. So it's just wonderful. And especially thanks to Kate for dedicating so much time over the last 10 years getting these projects up and running. So let's have some applause for Kate, please.
Thank you, Bobby. And thanks to everybody. And I'm sorry we couldn't cover all the wonderful projects that we do. There's so many more. So you do have a look at our website and you can see the huge number of projects and wonderful activities we do all over the world. And if you're interested in doing something or want to get in contact, you can email us pwf@ictp.it and you can follow us on the social media at ictppwf. Okay, thank you so much. Please, everyone stay in touch with us, email us, and we will catch up with everybody. And thank you, everybody in the room. And we'll sign off and say goodbye. Thanks, everybody. You can say
bye-bye.
Bye.
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 Bye.